Chapter 1 of Rough Justice. This is a Librivox recording. All Librivox recordings are in the public domain. For more information or to volunteer, please visit Librivox.org. Recording by Marina. Rough Justice by Mary Elizabeth Braddon. Chapter 1. How Should I Greet Thee?
Is it really, really you?
Really, and very really. But what, in the name of all that's wonderful, can have brought my little Mary to South Africa? They had come suddenly face to face in one of the corridors of the Saxon, face to face amid all the hubbub and confusion of a great steamer homeward bound. They stood there in the narrow corridor, cabin doors on either side of them, spellbound in the glad surprise of meeting, and unconscious that they were an obstruction to the passage of other eager spirits tramping to and fro, looking for lost packages, all more or less frantic, disputing about cabins and berths, in an atmosphere vibrating with farewells. These two forgot everything in the wonder of meeting, after an interval that to young minds seemed a great gap in life. To age, it would have been only a parenthesis. He was tall, dark with sun and weather, but originally of the fair Anglo-Saxon type, as witnessed by large, bold blue eyes and crisp, light brown hair. Age about 30, powerful frame and easy movements, a man who had lived mostly in the open and had looked the sun in the face, like the eagles. She, whom he called Little Mary, was at least 5'7", straight and slim as a reed, not by any means a beauty, but full of charm in her fresh youthfulness, with a smile of bewitching gaiety, and clear, dark grey eyes. Irish eyes, this old friend of hers had called them, in the days when she was Little Mary.
"You had better ask me what takes me home to England,"
she said, when he had repeated his question, eager, impatient, with both her hands clasped in his. The people pushing past them took them for brother and sister, or husband and wife, and thought them in the act of parting, and so were more tolerant than they might have been of this obstruction.
"We are awfully in the way here," said Mary Freeland. "Shall we go outside for a few minutes? You are not going on shore immediately, I hope."
"I am going on shore at Southampton, not before."
"What? Are we to be fellow passengers? How nice!"
"Isn't it?" Looking into her fresh, frank young face, it flashed upon him that it would be still nicer if they could be fellow passengers over the wide seas of life, a passing fancy only, which any man might have had about any woman as young and gay as Mary Freeland. Arnold Wentworth and his newly found friend went out upon the upper deck and stood watching the people thronging the narrow gangway, swarming down to the quay, perturbed by the importunate ringing of a warning bell, excited to fever point in the final parting. Some might be only friends, some mere acquaintances, but all were moved to some touch of tragic feeling while the clustered faces looked down upon them from the bulwarks, amidst waving hands and waving handkerchiefs, above and below. At last the bell ceased its clamour, the gangway was raised, the passengers' friends and followers drifted away, and Arnold and Mary were able to look at each other and talk to each other calmly, standing side by side in a quiet corner, away from the traffic of ship's officers and passengers, the latter mostly on the warpath. Table Bay lay around them, and Cape Town gleamed whitely in the clear afternoon light, sheltered in the vast amphitheatre of rock, curtained and protected by those grey cliffs, and dark with the dense growth of pine forests that fill the valley. In the golden light of an African summer it seemed too fair a scene to leave willingly, to exchange summer for winter. The large picturesqueness of South Africa for the fogs and narrow streets of London, and the commonplace of English rusticity. Arnold looked at those jutting headlands and titanic peaks with something of regret in his gaze.
"I'm getting quite accustomed to you again," said Mary presently, "but it was a tremendous shock to meet you."
"Why?"
The monosyllable startled her. She blushed rosy red, and answered confusedly, "Well, you see, you left Mervynhall so suddenly, and one didn't know, and people said things."
"Said I'd gone to the bad, no doubt."
"So shameful of them, just because you chose to leave a humdrum little town where you were not properly appreciated."
"Where I was confoundedly miserable. But it's a true bill, Polly, my dear. There is always a scamp in the family, and I suppose it was my mission to fill the part. I have been to the dogs, Polly, but I contrived to come alive out of the kennel, and for the last 2 years I've been doing well."
"In the diamond fields?"
"No, I turned up the diamond diggings. I have been among the gold miners at Heidelberg,
I tried my luck at Kimberley for a bit, but it was no go. And I drifted back to Cape Town worse off than when I landed there, for the clothes I had come in were worn to rags. And then a chap I knew at the Varsity, who had also had canine experience, turned up with a little bit of capital, and traded his cash against my knowledge of the mines and capacity for rough work. And the partnership answered better than such one-sided alliances generally do.
"At Heidelberg!" cried Mary. "And I have been at Johannesburg, only 30 miles away. Did you never go to Johannesburg?"
"Not very often."
"And did you go to the theatre when you were there?"
"Is there a theatre at Johannesburg?"
"Is there a theatre? Why, there are two!" cried Mary with a mortified air. "How little you care for the drama!"
"Not much. I've been leading rather too rough a life to care for stage plays."
"I'm glad you and your friend prospered at any rate."
"Well, you see, we bought a block in the Nigel Reef, a very small block. The large ones are owned by companies. And we had only a small capital to work with. But fortune was kind, and we did well. My chum had fever more than once, and I helped him to pull through, which he called saving his life. And here I am, homeward bound, on a flying visit to see my dear old mother, who never thought me quite the villain I appeared before the paternal High Court of Justice. And now for your story, little Mary. What brought you to the Cape, and above all, to Johannesburg?"
"I came with a company."
"A company?"
"A theatrical company. I'm an actress, you know."
"Indeed, I know nothing of the kind. You were a kid when we last met, a solitary orphan kid, but as bright and as happy as if you had been the centre of a jovial family. I should have thought your highly respectable aunt would have made a desperate fight against your turning actress."
"So she would, but she was too unkind, and I couldn't stand her any longer. You would never believe it."
And Mary blushed redder than before.
"But aunt wanted me to marry Dr. Betts."
"What? Why, the man must be 60, and he has worn a wig ever since I can remember him."
"And it's a wig that one can't help seeing. There's hardly any make-believe about it."
"And you plucked up a spirit and refused Betts? Did he make his offer in person?"
"Not at first. He only hinted at marriage. Said he wanted a nice little wife to cheer him of an evening, after a long day's round among his patients. He told me that a doctor appreciated a cheerful home more than any other professional man, and he asked me one day if I thought any nice young lady would accept him. I told him that he ought to look for some amiable person of his own age, if he wanted to be happy with his wife, since in all the novels I had ever read, the young women who married old men always eloped in the second volume, and came back to die miserably in the third. No sensible man would want to begin a story of that kind, I told him. He laughed, and said that the only merit in a novel was not to resemble life, and that he should not despair of winning some nice girl's heart."
"Presumptuous old idiot!"
"I thought he was only talking for talking's sake, just to fill the time between the porch and the garden gate, for aunt had sent me to see him to his carriage. But a week afterwards she told me he had proposed for me, and was willing to take me without a penny, and allow me 100 a year, paid quarterly, to buy clothes. She told me it was a particularly generous offer, for a girl who was almost plain."
"Plain? That's an outrageous lie."
"I'm so glad you think so. Of course, I know I'm not pretty, but people have generally liked me, and one doesn't want to think oneself repulsive."
"You were pretty enough to attract Dr. Betts, at any rate."
"Oh, Aunt said it was only his benevolence that made him propose for me. He knew that I was entirely dependent upon her, and it was out of pure kindness of heart he offered to make me Mrs. Betts, and the mistress of his beautiful house."
"What rot! What confounded rot!"
"You know his beautiful house. A round table in the middle of his drawing-room, and a walnut suite covered with magenta rep. I think I should go mad if I had to live in the midst of a walnut suite. Wouldn't you?" "Well, I said no, and no, and no, in spite of all Aunt could urge about the house, and the silver teapots and things, and the use of Dr. Betts' carriages when he didn't want them. I went on saying no, though Aunt got more and more cantankerous, and would hardly help me to pudding. I believe she'd have locked me up in an attic and kept me on bread and water if she hadn't been afraid of the Society for the Prevention of Cruelty to Children. I was only 17, so I suppose I should have ranked as an infant. And, to make a long story short, she worried me so that at last I plucked up a spirit and did just what you did."
"Eh?"
"I ran away. Don't look shocked. No doubt it was all through your bad example." "But where did you run to, child? Good God! 17 and friendless!"
"Not quite. I have no more aunts, and indeed, if I had 6, I doubt if I should have tried another. But I happen to have an uncle, my father's youngest brother, who married an actress while he was at Oxford, and went on the stage, and offended everybody belonging to him. I had seen in the papers that he was acting at Cambridge. So I just took a third-class ticket by the first morning train, and was in time for breakfast with my uncle and his wife at Market Hill, Cambridge. It was a very early train, you see, and a very late breakfast."
"Poor little waif! Didn't your uncle look rather blue at such an unexpected appearance?"
"Not a bit of it. Uncle and his wife were both as kind as ever they could be, and I told them everything. Uncle Joe said I had my father's eyes, and he would have known me as a Freeland anywhere. His stage name is Faversham. And they took a room for me at the top of the house, a weeny room with a sloping ceiling, and I walked on that very night."
"Walked on?"
"On the Cambridge stage, as a guest in a ballroom scene. Aunt lent me one of her frocks. I had only to stand and sit about and say nothing. It was to accustom me to the footlights. Uncle Joe said I was just the right age and had a good appearance, blushing at the recollection of having been called a pretty girl for the first time in her life, and that I ought to make an actress. He was manager of a touring company, you see, and was taking round his own melodrama, Holding R Up the Mail. A tremendous success everywhere. People liked it better than Shakespeare."
"Then my poor little Mary fell on her feet."
"Immensely. They were ever so good. Aunt is a leading lady, and a really fine actress, though she has been shamefully ignored by the London managers. I went about touring with them for nearly 3 years, in England, Scotland, and Ireland, and 15 months ago we all came to Africa, and we have been acting at Cape Town and Port Elizabeth and Johannesburg, off and on, ever since. My uncle brought me on board the boat. He had not gone 10 minutes when I saw you. I was awfully sorry to leave them."
"But why leave them? Have you another good-natured uncle up your sleeve?"
"I have not another relation in the world."
"Then why abandon these and face the world alone?"
"Because I have been left a fortune." "Please don't laugh. You would not call it a fortune. Aunt began by disinheriting me a week after I ran away. She made a will, leaving all her property to the Asylum for Idiots, and sent me a copy of it. 'I am leaving all I have to persons of your class,' she wrote. 'I did not know there were so many of you.'"
"The old lady must have thought herself a wit."
"I wrote and told her she was at liberty to leave her money to the shoeblack brigade. But whatever she might think, I was not ungrateful for past kindness. I had run away from Dr. Betts rather than from her. And then, from time to time, I used to send her a newspaper with a favorable notice, just to let her see that I was alive."
"What an artful young woman! I had no idea that curly brown head was screwed on so tight."
"Uncle Joe gave me the tip. 'Nothing like a good notice to soften the old lady's heart,' he used to say."
"You didn't send her the unfavorable notices, the cutters and slashers?"
"The notices that said I was overweighted or disappointing? Of course not. Well, I heard no more of her till she had been dead and buried ever so long, poor old dear. Then there came a long letter from Mr. Roffey. You remember Roffey, the solicitor? To say that my aunt had made a fresh will, shortly before her demise. He called it demise, so much less shocking than any other word, and had left me all her property, on condition that I left the stage, at once, formally and forever. Mr. Roffey and a Mr. Middleham, who was a great friend of aunt's, are my trustees, and hold the property in trust for me, to be forfeited and to go to the idiot asylum if ever I act in any theatre, hall, or place of entertainment where money is taken at the doors."
"Capital. And you are still free to exercise your talents in the Theatre Royal back drawing room?"
"Oh, I have no talent. I was just able to get on while I had aunt and uncle to teach me everything. But, of course, I was dreadfully inexperienced, and I heard a horrid low comedian tell the stage manager that if I hadn't been the gorgeous niece, I shouldn't have been allowed to deliver a message in a properly managed theatre."
"The gorger?"
"Name for the manager. Old-fashioned, I believe. The low comedian must have been 80.
"And you are free and independent. And pray, what are you going to do when you get back to England?"
"First, I'm going to Mervynhall."
"To take possession of your estate, naturally."
"And to see old friends, if they will see me. They may cut me, perhaps, for having run away and for having tried to be an actress. Not they. Prejudice in that line is ancient history. Besides, they are sure to feel kindly towards a nice young lady with a snug little property. Pray, at how much do you estimate your property? Aunt used to say that she had not quite 500 a year, besides the briary and the orchard and the three meadows. Not quite 500 a year is a very comfortable income for one young woman. You mustn't be in a hurry to marry. You must be on your guard against fortune hunters. Mary's cheeks reddened again, and this time the mounting colour had a look of sudden anger.
I am not going to marry, ever, perhaps. What a ridiculous warning!
Well, it's not always unnecessary. Nice girls are so soft-hearted. Any plausible fellow can get round them. And I dare say you have a corner in your heart for some Romeo or Benedict you've left behind you. Do you suppose I could care for an angel from heaven if he used grease paints? And now I've been prosing for nearly an hour about my adventures, so please tell me yours, and begin at the beginning.
There was a brief silence before Arnold replied, and then he began with a sigh.
Mary, my dear, my record isn't quite as clean as yours. My story is a long one, and would hardly bear telling. And all that is worst in it is dreariest, and would be the hardest to tell. We'll sweep it behind us, Mary. Send it away to sea with a flourish of my arm, as Mr. Podsnap used to wave away any subject he disliked. And you must be content to know that I have led an honest, hard-working life since I came to Africa, and that I have done pretty well, as I told you before, and am going home for a holiday before setting to work again.
You mean to come back, then? You like Africa?
It's about the only place I ever liked, the only life that ever suited me, the only country in which I have had good luck. Everything has gone well with me for the last 2 years. Indeed, I did so well at the Rand that I thought I was entitled to a bit of sport and adventure before I left Africa. So I bought a big wagon, and went off to Bechuanaland to shoot hartebeest, or anything else that came in my way, and look about me a little. The hot weather drove me out of the desert, but I took things very easily. I got back to Johannesburg with wagon and bullocks in very fair condition. I sold the whole turnout ever so much better than I expected. Fell in with a young swell who wanted the things, and wasn't hard about price, as an old colonist would have been.
"I hope you didn't cheat him," said Mary, laughing.
"You don't suppose I'm a swindler?" "No, I asked a fair price. Didn't even leave a margin for bargaining. He liked the look of my cattle, and he gave me what I asked, like a brick. Yes, Mary, I have been lucky. Luckiest of all in meeting an old friend like you.
Take care. Scotch people think a man is in danger when he's too happy. They call it being fey. I hope you're not fey."
"I shall be seasick by and by, perhaps, and that'll check my exuberant spirits. Are you a good sailor, Mary?"
"A very good sailor. I love the sea as well as if I were a mermaid. But do you know, Mr. Wentworth, now that I am quite grown up, and we are going to be fellow passengers for a long time, and among strangers, you mustn't call me Mary."
"What rot! Do you forget that you were a little girl when I was a full-grown man, and that all my recollections of you include short petticoats and a pinafore? Not call you Mary? Ridiculous!"
"Life is often ridiculous, and you will have to call me Miss Freeland, if you please, Mr. Wentworth," she said, smiling at him with mock dignity.
"And you will have to call me Wildover, Alfred Wildover, and not Wentworth, if you please, Miss Freeland, for that has been my name ever since I went under."
"You have changed your name? Oh, how dreadful!"
"Not for my people. It would have been dreadful for them to hear of a Wentworth in the gutter. A Wildover might go to the bad as he pleased, and nobody at Langton Park would care. I wanted to cut myself clear of family associations, to stand alone and free, and so I invented the name of Wildover, and I think it's rather a good one. I even changed Arnold to Alfred, so that there might be no clue to my identity if I went under altogether." The great steamer had been lying motionless all this time, for after all that clamorous bell-ringing and eager hurry to get rid of visitors, the captain seemed in no haste to weigh anchor, and it was dusk before the Saxon steamed out to sea. Mary Freeland retired to her cabin to unpack her trunk, and Wildover went to his own den, and they met no more that day, Mary not caring to appear at dinner, and spending her evening in a cushioned corner of the ladies' saloon. He saw her no more that night, but she was on deck next morning, as fresh as a rose, and had made friends with a family of children whose mother and governess were prostrate in their berths, and she was taking care of them, and they were taking care of her. Arnold, who had always been fond of kids, as he called them, made friends with these young people in 5 minutes, and attached himself to Miss Freeland's party, which included a black poodle of preternatural sagacity, who had been brought up in the bosom of the family, and received more care and attention than any of the children. Of these there were 5 in all, the eldest a sharp-witted damsel of 13, the youngest a boy of 7. They were tolerably well-behaved, having succeeded each other too rapidly for any of them to be spoilt, except the youngest, who was still called Baby, and who divided his mother's affections with Chip, the poodle. The lady placidly ignored the other 4, and had only one reply to any appeal from them, which was, "Ask Fräulein to do it for you," or, "Really, you must go to Fräulein." Arnold and Mary and the children found plenty of amusement on the Saxon, and perhaps in all those checkered years which had followed the crisis of severance from home and respectability, the young man had never known so placid and blissful an interval as that voyage from summer to winter. He accepted his happiness in the true lotus-eater spirit, thought of nothing, cared for nothing, but the light and frivolous amusements of the passing hour. It was only when the Saxon had passed Madeira that Arnold began to think of anything more serious than deck quoits, or the newest trick he was teaching Chip. Then one night in his cabin, being lucky enough, on account of the late season, to have a small midship's cabin to himself, the second berth being unclaimed, Arnold, after lying sleepless and full of thought for 3 or 4 weary hours, sat up in his berth, turned on the electric light, and unlocked a little cash box that stood on the table by his side. It was full of papers and paper money, checkbook, bankbook, private ledger. And under these, at the bottom of the box, where hope should have been, Arnold found a letter which for him represented despair. "There's no good in lying awake brooding over it," he said to himself, as he took the thin letter out of the thin envelope. "I had better read it quietly once more for the last time and think the matter out." Enclosed in the letter there was a slip of printed paper, evidently a cutting from a newspaper. Among the fortunate adventurers in the South African goldfields, one of the most striking personalities is Captain Wildover, a sportsman and a gentleman, a fine shot at big game, and as plucky as they make 'em. Wildover and his partner are said to have netted 100,000 since they started in a modest way at Nigel's Reef. This was the enclosure which gave the keynote to the letter. "To think that you should have forgotten me and your riches, you who were so good to me in our poverty. Oh, Arnold, I could not have believed that you could be prosperous and leave me to starve, even if you had formed new ties, if you had forgotten all that we once were to each other. No, my dear, remembering what you were, I cannot believe that you would be so cruel. So I am sure you have tried to find me and have failed, and have thought me dead, perhaps, or worse than dead, sunk in a sinful life, rich with the wages of sin. No, Arnold, I am not dead, nor fallen to that lower depth where your pity could not help me. I have lived on, waiting for happier days, waiting for you. When you were leaving me alone with my sad, almost broken heart, you swore that if you prospered you would come back to me and begin a new life with me as man and wife. We had been so friendless and alone in our poverty that there would be nobody to say hard things about our past if fortune should smile upon the future. I believed you and took comfort from your promises, between kisses and tears, in that dark hour of parting, when I stood beside you in the crowded steerage and would have given 10 years of my life, half my life, to be going with you, to share hardship and danger, only to be with you. You will never know what I have suffered in those 4 miserable years, the bitter poverty, the bitter degradation, turned out of one poor lodging after another, because of arrears and a rent of a few shillings a week, worried by the burden of debts that are counted by shillings, hunted from pillar to post, tramping all over London in all weathers, in search of employment, trying my hand at anything and everything. All that you and I have suffered together was light compared with what I have gone through since I have been alone. To be alone, is not that enough? To be alone and almost starving. And then I seem to have grown so common, to have sunk so near the level of my surroundings. I accept favors from such common people and am grateful. Who else is there to help me? The woman of this house is the kindliest landlady I ever had, and I have been lucky in getting a little needlework in the house, and have stayed here longer than anywhere else.
She gives me my garret for half a crown a week, though she might get more for it from any mechanic. She is patient when I am behindhand with my rent, and she patronizes me and pities me, and makes me go down to her kitchen sometimes, when I come in from one of my pilgrimages a little more tired than usual, and gives me tea and toast, and comforts me with the promise of better luck, and tells my fortune in the tea leaves at the bottom of my cup. Oh, Arnold, I am so weak and wretched that my heart beats and glows with hope when she tells me there is a fair man far off who bears me a good heart. Do you bear me a good heart? If this letter reaches you, will you answer it, and promise to come to me, and send me a little help from your riches? Just enough for me to keep body and soul together till you come? I have another friend in this house, one whose pitying kindness, which I try my hardest to avoid, hurts me more than Mrs. Grogan's favors. I have sunk so low as to accept pity from a woman of worse than doubtful character, a woman who paints her face, dyes her hair, and lives in a semi-detached manner under the protection of an elderly stockbroker, a woman who goes to a theater or a music hall nearly every night, and whose hansom I hear drive up to the door in the dead, dreary hours through which I so often lie awake, waiting for the gray London light. I had given her a wide berth till one winter evening, when she saw me dragging myself upstairs, feeling so faint and ill that I thought I should never get to the top of the house. She noticed my wretched state, and she put her arm round me and took me into her room. She was just going to sit down to dinner, and she put me in an easy chair by the fire, and gave me hot wine and water, and was so tender and sweet to me. A woman living a profligate life, Arnold, a creature deliberately immoral, not an accidental sinner like me. And yet she was so gentle, and so compassionate, and so womanly, that I wept tears of gratitude upon her breast. And after that night, I could never hold my head high when I met her on the stairs, nor pretend not to see her. We have been friends in a way, and I have sat by her fire sometimes on bitter days when my garret was fireless. And she has told me bits of her story, of the days when she lived with her father, a rich tradesman in a garrison town, and all the officers were in love with her. She must have been really beautiful in her youth, but she is only a handsome wreck now. She has no visitors, except the highly respectable city person whom she calls her guardian. And Mrs. Grogan says that her lodger's conduct out of doors is no business of hers. Poor wretch! I suppose she gets a better rent for her rooms from Mrs. Delamere than a spotless lodger would give. Come back to me, Arnold! Come back, and be my husband, if you think you are bound by old promises. Consider, dear, I have led an honest life since you left me. I have lived on the edge of death for honor's sake. But if not, come back and be my comrade and friend, as in the old days. I belong to you. I have neither shame nor pride where you are concerned. I have repented of my other sins, but never of loving you. If the love is not dead in your heart, come back to me. Lisa. The letter was addressed to A. Wildover, Esquire, at the Goldfields, Witwaters Rand, near Johannesburg, South Africa. End of chapter 1.
Chapter 2 of Rough Justice. This is a LibriVox recording. All LibriVox recordings are in the public domain. For more information, or to volunteer, please visit LibriVox.org. Recording by Mary Herndon Bell. Rough Justice by Mary Elizabeth Braddon. Chapter 2. A Fellow Feeling. Arnold sat staring straight before him across the narrow space of his windowless cabin. He had read Lisa's letter now for the third time, slowly, thoughtfully, realizing the full force of every word, seeing the vision of the woman he had loved, her sufferings and deprivations, her sheep-like patience, the meek endurance of a woman whom the world had used ill. To this woman fate had been merciless. A profligate father, a passionate, hysterical mother, a miserable childhood, the fatal gift of beauty, and, with that essentially feminine beauty, a sensitive, susceptible nature. Arnold knew the story of her temptation and her fall, how within a year of her mother's death she had exchanged a wretched, wandering life with her father for a fool's paradise at the West End of London, under the protection of a Viennese banker, with the inevitable result of ill usage and desertion. She had kept no humiliating circumstance of that cruel story from the man she loved, the man who was really good to her, and who was as poor and almost as helpless as she was. They had found each other in the hour of despair, and their desolate hearts had gone out to each other in an impulse of pity and love. How well he remembered that meeting, the sultry evening late in August, when all the prosperous people had left London, and there was a lull in the traffic of the streets, and the lights were fewer because of closed theatres and music halls. Oh, the stony heartedness of London streets at this dead season to the man with empty pockets, for whom no friend cares, no hospitable door opens. He had been roaming aimlessly about London all day, lying on the sunburnt grass in Hyde Park for an hour or two in the hottest part of the afternoon, trying to realize the French proverb that he who sleeps dines. He had not found that siesta a substitute for a beefsteak. He had spent his last copper to give himself a meal at a workman's coffee house, where the eggs were of doubtful freshness and the tea had a second-hand flavor, as if it had been made with cast-off tea leaves. As the evening grew towards dusk, he had sauntered to Waterloo Bridge and sat there with his back against the parapet, in the quiet of the deepening twilight, admiring the long Italian facade of Somerset House, and wondering whether he should drown himself. He had carried the idea of suicide about with him for a long time, and if it had not been for the compunction natural to every prodigal son who has a fond mother, he might have wound up his difficulties before that dreary August night. Today, however, there had been something in the atmosphere, the dusty dryness, the odor of scorching pavements and stale provisions and dirty people and old clothes, the odor of London poverty, which had depressed him below his usual low-water mark. There was nothing for it but to enlist, let himself out as a machine to carry a musket, or to kill himself, and he thought the bottom of the river might be better than the barrack yard. He waited for darkness and such an interval in the traffic on the bridge and on the water below as would allow him to get over the parapet unnoticed and drop quietly into the river. And while he waited, sitting on one of the stone benches, a woman, who walked slowly past him, looked at him with a curious attention. There was just daylight enough left for them to see each other's faces. He noticed that hers had a faded beauty, which is always pathetic, and even in that first look as she passed him, he could see that she was not an unfortunate. She was very poorly clad, in black, and her pale features were innocent of all embellishment. The earnest manner in which she looked at him could hardly have been misconstrued by the dullest mind. He watched her as she went to the end of the bridge, and in his utter loneliness and blank despair, he felt a faint sense of regret at seeing no more of her. "The poor thing saw my sad case, and was sorry for me," he thought, watching the slim black figure as other figures passed it by at the end of the bridge. He was startled to see her turn suddenly and walk slowly back. It was as if his thought had summoned her, and he, who called thought transference rot and hypnotism humbug, smiled grimly. Of course his existence had nothing to do with her movements. She came slowly back and seated herself at the other end of the bench on which he was sitting, as if he had willed her to come to him, he thought, in spite of his skepticism. They sat thus in silence for about 10 minutes, and then in a shy voice she made some little remark about the weather. The night was so sultry, the air so oppressive. He answered courteously, and they talked for a few minutes of indifferent things, the dreariness of London at this season. He knew somehow that she had a purpose in talking to him, and that the serious side of her mind would show itself presently. There was an awkward silence, and then she said, "I hope you do not think badly of me. "Impossible," he interrupted eagerly. "For having spoken to you, a perfect stranger, you were looking so very, very miserable as I passed you, that somehow I could not go home in peace and leave you here. Your face would have haunted me all night. I should have dreamt dreadful dreams about you. This is the bridge from which people used to drown themselves, years ago."
"Years ago? Do they never do it now?"
"I think not. There are too many people passing now that the bridge is free."
"Ah, the halfpenny toll made a solitude, I suppose, and any poor wretch who was sick of his life could find time and opportunity to chuck it away." Again there was a silence, embarrassed upon her part, moody on his. He began to understand her now. She knew he meant suicide. It was shrewd of her to have read his thoughts, she a casual passer-by. He was touched by her concern for him, and began to study her face as she sat at the other end of the bench, looking straight before her in the faint gray light. It was a delicate, prettily modeled face, and it was a young face, though care had written lines upon it and hollowed the oval cheek, and given a sad downward droop to the mouth.
"Do you live near here?" she asked presently. "And do you come here of an evening for the fresh air from the river?"
"I live nowhere just at present. I had a very decisive notice to leave my lodgings last night. I was locked out."
"Poor man, that is hard. And you have nowhere to go?"
"Yes, I have somewhere, and I am going there presently, when I have enjoyed the fresh air from the river and your agreeable society." The defiance of his tone, the cynical sneer and touch of brutality confirmed her in that conviction which had flashed into her mind at first sight of his face and attitude.
"Oh, don't give way to despair," she pleaded. "Think as badly of me as you like, for speaking so freely to a stranger, for troubling myself about a stranger's fate."
"Think badly of you? Not a bit. You belong to some rescue society, I dare say, and this is all in your evening's work."
"It isn't kind of you to sneer at me, only because I saw a stranger in trouble and couldn't help caring. I can only beg you, if you had that dreadful intention I fancied, to put it away from you. Who can ever tell what the future may bring? So long as one is young and in tolerable health, racked by no cruel, incurable disease, there is always a chance. You know the vulgar proverb, the longest lane. Good night."
She rose towards the end of her speech. The latter part of it was spoken standing, and with the last words she moved quickly away. But he sprang up and darted after her and caught her by the arm.
"Don't leave me just yet," he said. "Do you think a despairing wretch is to be saved so easily? Stop. Your pity has touched me. Forgive me for trying to sneer it down. I didn't want to be made to feel human again. I have been feeling an angry devil, a lost spirit. I should have gone with clenched fists to meet the great judge, if there be one, or anything, after the weeds in one's hair and the river mud in one's mouth."
"You won't think of that wicked act any more?"
"Not tonight, at any rate. You have humanized me. What a good soul you must be to take such heed of a stranger's trouble. I once sat on this bridge for 2 hours, meaning what you meant tonight. And some kind soul guessed? No, no. No one spoke to me. No one guessed. I sat and listened to the clock striking, and I thought in another quarter of an hour it would be darker. And I waited and waited, and I was a coward. I was afraid of the jump and the plunge. So I went back to my wretched room and let my landlady bully me. And I got some work the next day. My luck changed, and I clung to this poor life."
"Ah, it was sympathy that made you understand my case. Well, you are a good Samaritan."
"Without even tuppence to offer you."
"You have given me more than 1,000,000 pence. You have interested me in something outside of my own miserable, used-up existence." Be my friend, dear girl. Tell me all about yourself. Who knows? This may be the turning in my dismal lane. I have need of you, kind, compassionate creature. He was holding her. He put his arm round her waist in the darkness and tried to draw her to him, but she struggled away from him. "Do you think I am a bad woman because I was sorry for you?" she asked indignantly. "I think you are an angel of compassion and goodness. You insult me. Is it an insult to want your affection, to yearn for a kiss from those gentle lips? You were sorry for me, and pity is akin to love. I am grateful to you, and gratitude is love." "Good night," she said again, and hurried away from him, walking very fast towards the Surrey shore. Quick as her pace was, she could not escape him. He overtook her a little way from the bridge, and again he took her arm in his strong grip, not roughly, and walked at her side. "Come, let there be no nonsense between us," he said impetuously. "An hour ago I was a solitary wretch with nothing to live for, nothing between me and the bottom of the Thames. Your pity, something else perhaps, something that I have never seen in any other woman, has given me back my interest in life. An hour ago I wanted to die, and now I want to live, because of you. But if you go out of my life again, if you say we are to be strangers, well, I fall back upon my original intention, and so, after a brief pause, good night." He released her arm as suddenly as he had seized it, lifted his hat, and walked away from her towards the bridge. This time it was she who followed him. "For God's sake, don't go back," she pleaded. "Be reasonable. What can I do but pity you? What can I, almost as poor as you are, do to make your life better?" "Love me," he answered passionately. "Love me. My heart has been one great ache for the loneliness of this hideous town. You are the first woman of all I have met and passed in this stony labyrinth since my ill luck began that has gone out of her way to pity me. There were smilers enough and challenges enough from eye and lip while I was prosperous, but since I have been threadbare and out at elbows, not a glance that meant kindness. You could stop to pity me, gentle Samaritan. Give me something more than idle pity." "You talk as you would to the women of the streets," she said in a distressed voice. "No, no, no. On my soul, no. Is there no swift, sudden love, except the love that is bought?" "I am not what the world calls a good woman, but I do not belong to that class." "I know it. Such a thought never entered into my mind. Do you suppose I am such a dolt as not to comprehend purity when I meet it? Pity, beneficence, the qualities that make ministering angels." "Ah, now your praise sounds like mockery. Indeed, there is nothing for us but to shake hands and say good-bye. You will not be so wicked as to think any more of suicide. You will wait and see what Providence will do for you. And please accept this shilling. Indeed, indeed, I can spare it. And get a crust of bread and a bed somewhere." He pushed away the slender hand that was trying to slip the coin into his palm. "No, I will accept no favor from a woman who whistles me off so lightly. Tell me who you are, where you live, when I may see you again. Tell me, and then I will take half your shilling, and get myself a supper, and sit in St. James Park and think of you till morning." She refused, but the pleading voice, a deep, strong voice that sounded like passionate music, was irresistible. If he were lonely, was she not lonely too? She yielded so far as to promise to meet him in Birdcage Walk at 8 o'clock on the following night. She would not tell him where she lived, or her name, yet a while. "You will not cheat me," he asked. "I give you my word of honor. If I am alive tomorrow night, I will be there. I will trust you." He changed the shilling at a great gaudy public house and gave her one of the 2 sixpences. Do you remember how Lucy Ashton and her lover divided a piece of gold between them as a token of lifelong fidelity? We divide a loaf of bread. And so they parted. Shall I ever see her again? He wondered, as he walked slowly westward. Will she keep her promise? Could it be love, this warm interest in a woman whom he had never seen before tonight? Was it love? Impossible, he told himself. But the strange circumstances of their acquaintance, her compassion, her frankness and courage, were enough to account for his keen interest in her, his longing to see her again, to make her in some wise his own. She came to me in the hour of my despair. I am not going to let her go, he said to himself, over and over again in the summer night. He had a hearty supper of bread and cheese and porter, 6 penny worth in all, in one of the taverns that open in the small hours for the market people. He sat in a corner, amidst an odour of cabbages with the dew on them, a faint sweetness of herbs and flowers, and ate and drank, thinking of the pale, worn face and the friendly hand to which he owed the tardy meal. He thought he had never in his life enjoyed a meal so much. "That swipes was better than all the fizz I ever drank," he muttered, as he set down the empty pot. He went into the cool dawn like a giant refreshed, and slept sweetly on a bench in St. James Park, under the rosy morning sky, lulled by the chirruping of London birds and the flutter of ruffled leaves. And all next day he looked for work, with an energy he had not known of late. He had gone about in a low-spirited, ill-tempered way, as if he had been seeking failure. Today he went everywhere with a bright countenance, a happy-go-lucky air that was irresistible. Before the day was done, he had succeeded in two directions. The editor of a sporting paper had promised to consider any articles upon varsity athletics or varsity sport which he might send in, and to pay him fairly for his copy if it were accepted. And better still, the acting manager of a second-rate music hall engaged him as general assistant in front of the house, and chucker out, at 15 shillings a week, with a promise of better pay if his services proved satisfactory. "You won't have to wear a uniform like those big foreign chaps at the West End," said the manager. "We don't run to that. I suppose you got a dress suit." "I have, but it's at the cleaner's. You'll have to advance me a week's pay if you want me to wear it." "And how do I know if I shall ever see that good-looking mug of yours again if I do? You look like a gentleman, but that sort is sometimes the worst." "That's your business. With your wide experience of life, you ought to know an honest man when you see one." "Well, there's your money. I must risk it. I like the cut of your jib. You look like a varsity man, and you're built for strength, though you're woefully out of condition. I've been worrying myself lately. And not eating enough, perhaps. You'd better take another 5 bob, and put a little beef and beer inside you before Saturday." He was to begin his new duties on Saturday night. He knew enough of such places of amusement to know that his post would not be a sinecure. He was glad that the hall was a third-rate place on the Surrey side of the river, since he was less likely to be recognized by family friends or the men he had known at Cambridge. He had not a large circle of acquaintance. His father was a small Suffolk squire, living quietly upon an estate that had belonged to his race for nearly 3 centuries. Proud, as such people are proud, of names and acres, never having been ground in that great cosmopolitan mill which reduces all individualities, short of a prime minister, a duke, an inventor, or a quadruple millionaire, to inconsiderable atoms. The Wentworths of Langton Park lived in the narrowest circle, and the majority of Arnold's acquaintance were the friends he had made for himself at Cambridge. These, he thought, were very unlikely to cross the Thames in quest of amusement, since any new light that illuminated those obscure reasons would, so soon as discovered by the managerial eye, be invited to blaze upon West End London. He accepted the engagement, therefore, without compunction, saw no degradation in being hired to keep order among roughs, to show people to their seats, to help the overworked waiters even on occasion, and serve drinks. To a man who had been face to face with starvation and death, no honest employment need seem degrading. 15 shillings a week. He could get a clean attic on the Surrey side for 4 shillings, spend 1 shilling a day on food, and have 4 shillings a week for shoe leather and laundress. But 12 shillings out of the pound he had just received would go to the pawnbroker who had custody of his dress suit, and he would have to maintain himself for 1 week, perhaps 1 fortnight, upon 8 shillings. A problem in economics, assuredly, but he had other resources. There was a cricket match on the Oval that afternoon, so when he had found the room he wanted in a tidy street near the Lambeth Road, and had washed and furbished himself with much brushing of threadbare tweed and well-blacked boots, so that he might not sink with shame at encountering an acquaintance, he paid his 6 pence and watched the heroic struggle of a weak Sussex against a strong Surrey, and joined in the clamour and excitement of the scene, and forgot that he had eaten nothing but a penny roll since 2 o'clock in the morning. Luck favoured him so far that the only acquaintance he saw was in the Surrey team, and unconscious of his existence. He stayed till the close of play, took a meal of tea and cold meat in a coffee shop at Vauxhall, and then strolled through the summer evening to St. James Park. Would she keep her promise? He thought she would, thought that her loneliness was little less than his own, and that she had almost a bitter need of sympathy. She would not have so felt for his woes if they had not been like her own. He remembered the opium-eater's gentle friend, the story of love in poverty. Was not their situation much the same, friendless and poor, in the lap of the stony-hearted stepmother London, the injusta novica of poverty, the sycophant and the ministering slave to wealth? She was sitting on a bench in a little bit of ornamental ground opposite Queen Anne's gate, waiting meekly, very neat and prim in her threadbare black frock and black straw hat. Last night she had been gloveless. Tonight she wore gloves that were in themselves a history, so carefully mended, so old and thin. She blushed at his coming, like a girl at the sight of a first lover. The man who could confound her with the vicious classes must have been indeed a thick-skinned brute. They sat and talked together, and walked about the park together in the summer darkness till 10 o'clock. He told her the history of his day. "You are my mascot, perhaps," he said. "I have had better luck today, have got something to do that will keep me from starving." And then he told her about the engagement at the Comet Music Hall, but instead of being pleased, she was shocked at the idea. "I know you are a gentleman, and have never mixed with such people," she said. "It seems dreadful you should sink so low." "Oh, I am something of a radical. I think nothing low that isn't felonious. I don't suppose I shall quite like giving the waiters a helping hand when the hall's full, but I shall enjoy the chucking out. It will remind me of my happiest days." "Why not go back to your friends?" she asked. "I know you must belong to nice people somewhere." "I belong to no one but myself, my dear. Besides you, I have but one friend in the world, my mother, and she was too weak to shield me from my father's tyranny. He and I could not live in the same house after I was a man. My manhood rose against domestic despotism. I turned my back upon a home that was a wasp-nest of petty irritations, and everybody belonging to me cried out upon my villainy. No, dear little friend, for me there is no going back. I have to make my own life, and to find happiness where I can." When the horse guard's clock struck 10, she stopped in the midst of their talk and bade him good night. He wanted her to stay later, but she said her landlady would be horrified if she was not indoors before 11. And then he wanted to walk home with her, but she was obdurate, and would not even let him know where she lived. The next night was Saturday, and his engagement at the Comet was to begin. There could be no evening walk in the park. She promised to meet him in Kennington Park on Sunday afternoon. "It will be nearer where you live," he said artfully. He put her into the Brixton omnibus at Charing Cross, and then walked to his Lambeth lodgings, and sat down to write a criticism on Surrey cricket. He was not literary by any means, had failed to get his degree, and had brought down the paternal wrath upon himself for that and other failures. Failure to live upon his allowance, for instance. But he was no dunce, and could write plain English with a good swing in it, and in writing of cricket, football, or athletics, he was writing about what he knew. The editor praised his copy, and paid him half a sovereign for it on the nail. "Do you want to sign the article with your own name?" he asked. "I have no name." "Then you'd better take a nom de plume," said the editor. "We like names. You seem pretty knowledgeable. Suppose we call you The Man Who Knows." The paper was a new one, called itself In the Know, and aimed at being as modern and as slangy as sporting papers are made. It was printed on yellow paper, and aspired to become popular as the Yallerun. They met in Kennington Park on more than one afternoon in the sultry August. He took her to see a match at the Oval, and they had tea together at a little Swiss shop in the Kennington Road. They were fast friends, and yet he knew only her Christian name. For him, she was only Lisa, and for her, he was Arnold. And so this gentle friendship continued for nearly a month, the bond strengthening day by day, though she hardly knew how strong it was growing. And then, one Sunday night, his only free night, they walked longer and later than usual. She forgot her landlady's hours and the possibility of being scolded, forgot the passage of time as she walked to and fro in the deep shadow of the trees in the most secluded part of Hyde Park, listening to Arnold's pleading. He was asking for more than her friendship. He wanted her love. He wanted her. Why should she withhold herself from him? He knew she loved him. She had saved him from an ignominious death. He belonged to her, and she to him. He pleaded in such plain, strenuous language as a working man might have used to his sweetheart, and she accepted him, lover or husband. There were reasons in her own mind which withheld her from even asking what the tie was to be. She gave herself to him unconditionally, having loved him from the night of their first meeting, having melted at his voice and trembled at his touch in all the time she had maintained an almost severe reserve. The clock struck 12 while they were talking. "What will Mrs. Marmion say to me? She has such a dreadful temper." "She shall have no chance of saying anything tonight. My home is your home, now you have promised to trust yourself to me." They went home together. His landlady was of the easy-going type, sat up late herself, and wasn't shocked at late hours in a lodger, and was not averse to an offer of a glass of whiskey. "I've brought my wife home, Mrs. Barwick," Arnold said coolly. "You didn't know I was married, did you? She has just come from her friends in the country, and her train was late. Her luggage will be here tomorrow." End of chapter 2.
Chapter 3 of Rough Justice. This is a LibriVox recording. All LibriVox recordings are in the public domain. For more information or to volunteer, please visit LibriVox.org. Recording by Lena Emsley. Rough Justice by Mary Elizabeth Braddon. Chapter 3. Alone in London. Their new lives began in perfect harmony and happiness. There was no question of marriage. If she had possessed that steadfast strength, that power to resist tender impulses, and that lofty self-esteem which make high principle in woman, she could have made her own terms with him. But she was by nature submissive and unexacting, and she had been crushed under the grinding wheel of poverty, and had suffered the world's contempt. From the first she was his slave, devoted to him, esteeming herself happy if she could but make his life a little happier. She was the daughter of an adventurer, and had led the casual, shifty life of the out at elbows and the homeless ever since she could remember, and in this chequered existence had learnt many small arts. She could cook a dinner, or trim a hat, was an artist with her needle, and so was able to eke out Arnold's small earnings and to keep the wolf from the door, even when things were worst. But there were intervals when In the Know was using a good deal of Arnold's copy, and then they lived merrily. They had been living thus for a year, and a child had been born to them, a child that lived only a week, and whose death had a terrible effect upon the mother. She had a long and dangerous illness, through which Arnold nursed her day and night, giving up his engagement at the music hall for that purpose, hoping to maintain her and himself by the use of his pen. As the man who knows, he had become a feature on the yellow paper, and as long as the paper and his popularity lasted, he was sure of £3 a week. It was in the beginning of her convalescence, and while she was still light-headed at night, that Lisa told her lover the secret of her past.
"I dare say you think me worse than I am, because I never asked you to marry me," she said brokenly. "Not even when our baby was coming. If I had been a good woman, I should have wanted to be your wife. But you never asked me what my youth had been, and I felt I had no right to ask you to give me your name, unless I could tell you that I was worthy."
"Dear girl, you are worthy. Tell me nothing. I want to know nothing about the past. I know you. Surely that's enough. It is the woman and not the history that counts. You have been true and dear, and have loved me as no one ever loved me before you. Make haste and get well, and I will marry you as soon as you are strong enough to stand up in a church or registrar's office."
"You won't say that when you know all," she sobbed, and then she told him her pitiful story. The daughter of an unprincipled man, steeped in debt and difficulty, shifting his quarters from city to city, clever enough to live where a duller rascal would have starved, utterly neglectful of wife and daughter, unmoved when the broken-hearted wife succumbed to the misery of her existence, and letting his 17-year-old daughter tramp the streets of the wickedest city in Europe and fetch and carry for him. Young, pretty, ill-clad, with that low standard of self-respect which is the natural result of a childhood steeped in poverty and debt, the motherless waif was an easy prey for a scoundrel. The first man's voice that had ever spoken tenderly to her was the voice of the seducer.
"I was so unhappy, so tired and ill, when he first spoke to me, and I thought it was only for pity that he took notice of me. He was old enough to be my father. I had no fear of him. I looked up to him as a superior being, my friend, my benefactor. He promised to find employment for my father, to make our lives happier. I used to see him every day as I went about our poor little marketing, or went to the pawnbroker's for my father. And one day..."
Convulsive sobs stopped the pitiful story. Arnold urged her to tell him no more. The past was past. She was no less dear to him because of her unhappy girlhood.
"No, no, no. You must know all, all. And then, if you still think I am fit to be your wife..."
He tried hard to stop her, but she insisted, and in broken sentences, interrupted by hysterical sobbing, she told him how she had been left in London, and how she had starved and struggled, and kept herself out of the lowest depth to which lost women go down. She had been as near suicide as he had. She had lived on a few pence a day, had put her hand to anything that she could find to do, had lived for a week on a West End dressmaker's pay for one day's work.
"Tell me no more, dear, except the name of the man who wronged you. I should like to know, so that I may have a name to hate him by."
"What does his name matter? He is a great man in Vienna. Everybody looks up to him there, as I did before I knew what he was. If you were to tell people how he treated me, they would not believe you. I hate myself for having listened to him, and loved him. I did love him, Arnold. Not as I love you, but with the love of an ignorant girl who had never been praised or tenderly treated. He was kind to me, generous, indulgent, while his whim lasted, and then he left me without an hour's warning. His valet brought me a letter, good-bye, and a £20 note. His master was starting for Vienna at 8 o'clock that evening, and then I knew what it was to be alone in London. He was tender with her, and seemed full of pity, yet her story chilled him. He had guessed that there was a history, that some deeper woe than poverty had clouded her girlhood, that her soul had gone down into deep waters. But this story of a middle-aged lover, a street acquaintance, was wanting in every element of romance. She had been fond of her seducer, fond of the man who praised her and lavished gifts upon her. She regretted him even now, perhaps, looked back and sighed for the luxury of Brompton lodgings, a brougham and fine clothes, looked back from their shabby second floor in Margaretta Street, Lambeth. She saw no change in him yet, but the slow, day-by-day death of a worn-out love had begun. His love was dying by inches, though he hardly knew it. He thought he was tired of this wretched London life, this stony labyrinth and smoke-darkened sky, not of her. Things were going badly with them. She was weak after her illness, too weak for an occasional day's dressmaking at the West End, and so one element of earning was gone. He had been precipitate in giving up the music hall, for he found the in-the-know people were becoming bad paymasters. He had to call 3 or 4 times at the office for the few pounds owing to him. Life was harder than it had been. The rent of the shabby lodging was in arrear, and the easy-going landlady looked at him gloomily in the shadow of the narrow passage as he went out or came in. "If you find 7 shillings a week too much to pay, you'd better manage with 1 room," she said, and Arnold agreed that in his present circumstances 1 room must do. He had taken the extra room when Lisa and he joined fortunes. Oh, the misery of that 1 room, where there was room for nothing! The Pembroke table at which he wrote, screwed into a corner where his elbows were cramped by the walls, while Lisa did some bit of fine laundry work or prepared their composite meal at another table. The squalor of it, to a man reared amongst ample spaces and pleasant surroundings, and in the clear air of Suffolk fields and woods. An invincible longing to escape from those 4 walls seized him. He almost regretted the music hall, the vulgar songs, the stamping dancers, the dust and glare, the riot and noise. At least there were movement and life at the music hall. Here there was a deadly quiet. Lisa was dull and depressed for want of change of air after her illness, and she had a nervous monosyllabic cough that tortured him by its measured recurrence. There was a loud Dutch clock on the landing, and he knew almost to a moment how many seconds it ticked off between Lisa's coughs. When he was writing for his paper, trying to be bright and lively, to adorn his record of boat race or cricket match with the highest top sparkle of Cockney humour, that recurrent cough, slight as it was, made him grind his teeth in nervous agony. Life would have been tolerable if he had had a den, he thought, a mere closet where he could shut himself in and not hear every movement of his poor companion, and not smell the sausages or the bloaters that she was frying for the tea dinner, and not be painfully conscious of every detail of this squalid existence. They were soon to sink into deeper misery. He had not thrown up his situation at the Comet 3 months, when that other, and, as he once thought, better, source of income, dried up altogether. In the know died the mute, inglorious death of newspapers that fail. There were no convulsions of the parting spirit. Nobody knew it was passing.
The yellow periodical simply ceased to be. Its slang, its stupendous up-to-datishness, its yellow paper, had not served to keep life in it for 2 little years. Nobody had ever been induced to call it the Yellerun. It died and made no sign. Arnold only knew of his bereavement when he went to the office in quest of a business manager who had been very difficult to access of late, though the editor had been unusually eager for copy from the man who knows. The office, a ground floor in a shabby street between the Strand and Longacre, was shut, and a bill in one of the windows announced that these eligible premises were to let. For further particulars, apply to Messrs. Barnard and Badger, auctioneers and estate agents, Queen Street. Arnold did not trouble Barnard and Badger. What good could further particulars do him? He had seen impending ruin in the conduct of editor and proprietor, in the shuffling avoidance of his claim for payment, in the pacifying him with an occasional sovereign on account instead of a cheque in full. The yellow newspaper was dead, and that meant starvation. There were other papers, of course, which treat of athletics and of manly sports, such as he loved to share in, to witness, or even to write about, but all the old established paying papers had their staff and would hardly desire contributions from an outsider in the worst sense of the word, Arnold thought with a pang of self-contempt. He walked homeward by St. George's Circus and looked in at the Comet. No, there was no berth for him there. They had found an Aberdeen railway porter of 6 feet 4 and proportionate bulk, whom they had put in a uniform, plastered with gold lace, and who gave the hall an air which Arnold's threadbare dress suit could never impart. No, his services were no longer worth bread and cheese at the Comet. Now came the wretched, wearing, hand-to-mouth existence, the daily fight for the day's food and shelter. How could love live in such an atmosphere? It did live, for one of the two. The woman went on loving, with that love of woman or dog which is deathless. The man sickened of the struggle, and hated his life so much that he began to be afraid of hating his life's companion. They were good and tender to each other through it all. When she was ill, and she was often ill, he nursed her. On those rare occasions when his strong frame sunk under his burden, and the sickness of exhaustion fell upon him, she nursed him, and fed him, somehow, with the earnings of her day's toil. He never knew that at these times she sometimes did half a day's charing for a shilling to buy his dinner. It was the year that the diamond fever raged fiercest at Kimberley, and men in England who knew nothing of the restrictions or the difficulties of the mining district thought that wealth was waiting for them out yonder beside the Orange River. One of the contributors to the defunct sporting paper, the man who had written the turf articles, met Arnold walking the Strand, gaunt and shabby, and took him into an oyster shop and gave him a lunch. This gentleman had been luckier in backing the winners in the great autumn races than those readers who had believed in his prophecies when he wrote for In the Know. He had won a few hundreds, and had heard of that Tom Tiddler's ground in South Africa, and being of a sanguine disposition, was ready to back his luck there. He looked up to Arnold as a man of better education, and better thews and sinews than himself, and offered to take him to the diamond mines. He was not going to Kimberley, but to Barclay West, 20 miles off the centre of the river diggings, where a man with a small capital might have a chance of luck if he worked hard enough. The river diggings were the poor man's diggings. "You will have 20% of all we make," he told Arnold. "I'm a social bird, and I hate the idea of going alone. And if you haven't got the youth for the passage, why, I'll pay your fare, steerage." "You're very good, but that isn't enough," Arnold answered, his face flushing and his eye brightening at the thought of escape. "I can't leave a friend to starve. I should want a £10 note to leave behind me. The reprobate was good-natured. He lent, or gave, Arnold £10 over and above his passage money, and this, a large sum when measured by their late deprivations, Arnold gave to Lisa. "I'm no good to you," he said. "For the last 3 months you have been the only breadwinner, except for a casual quid once in a blue moon. You have been keeping me, toiling for me, Lisa. Be sure you will do better alone." "Better?" The anguish in the voice, the white despair in sunken cheek and quivering lips, smote him with a sense of shame. He knew that she was heartbroken, and that he was glad to get away from her, from the four walls, the London sky, the cramped, wretched life. Those were the things he was so glad to leave. And for her, well, her existence was linked with them. All that was generous in his nature was aroused by her sorrow. All that man could say to comfort woman, those lips of his spoke to her as she clung to him and sobbed upon his breast in that unspeakable agony of parting. "Dearest, if I live and prosper, I will come back to marry you and make a lady of you. I swear it. Come, love, be brave. Who knows? I may do well at the mines. There are men who began there with the clothes they stood in, as I shall, and who are triple millionaires today. I mean to make my fortune for your sake, Lisa. I shall come back a rich man, and you shall share my good luck as you have shared my penury."
"No, Arnold, no, you will never come back. You have been too miserable with me."
"Ah, but I have been happy too. You are the only woman I ever really loved, and if I prosper, you shall prosper too." And so they parted, on her side with despairing tears, on his with kisses and promises. The remembrance of the words he had spoken then smote him now, as he sat in his berth, in the night loneliness, with her letter in his hand.
"If you think you are bound by those promises," she wrote. "If! He knew he was bound by them. Honour and conscience declared those vows binding. He had given his promise unsolicited, since she had been ever unselfish and unexacting. And even in reminding him of what he had promised, she had absolved him in advance if he wanted to break his word. She urged him only to go back to her, to be again her protector and her friend, to love her as he loved her of old. Alas, that could not be. He might go back and redeem his promise and marry her, but the love born of despair, the sudden sympathy between two solitary creatures, desolate in a crowded world, was in Arnold's heart and mind only a memory of something that had once been sweet and dear. He could never think of Lisa Rayner without tenderness, but he had long ceased to love her. The years in which they had been parted were the long years of eventful manhood. He had lived a new life. He felt himself a new man. That larger life of an adventurer among many adventurers, of the strong man among strong men, had moulded mind and body and had put a new mark upon him. He had lived in a world where all was young and fresh, eager, courageous, hopeful. How could he expect happiness if he were to ally himself with that broken life that he had left behind, the faded, saddened woman whose mind was shadowed and dulled by the bitterest memories, upon whose face care had drawn such cruel lines? And worst of all, as he recalled that faded face, another face shone out beside it, so fair, so fresh, so radiant with youth and hope, that the contrast between the two was wide as the difference between light and shadow. Oh, happy face, in its frank outlook, its innocent fearlessness, the sign and token of an unsullied life! Sweet face, which he had been watching and studying in the idle days over that wintry sea, and which had made December bright as June! Sweet Mary! It is not for beauty I love you, he said to himself, musing sadly, with Lisa's letter still in his hand. I have seen prettier faces, but never a face so radiant with youth and hope. My merry Mary, my joyous, light-hearted girl. He looked back wonderingly at those old days in Suffolk, when Mary had been, in some way or other, his almost daily companion. His mother had compassionated her loneliness in the maiden aunt's prim household, and Mary had been given the run of the classroom and garden, and had been accepted as Beatrice Wentworth's companion and playfellow. Beatrice was Arnold's only sister, his junior by 5 years and 2 years older than little Mary. Mary was still little Mary when Arnold left home, still a child, a tall slip of a thing that had just passed its 12th birthday and was boastful of being in its teens. "I'm in my teens, you know," she used to say reprovingly when Arnold teased her. "You'll have to leave off pulling my hair." "Then you'll have to leave off having such a preposterous mop. The temptation is too strong for me," Arnold would reply. He was very fond of little Mary, his Molly, his Polly, his Flippity-Witchet. He had all kinds of foolish names with which to tease her, but in talking about her she was always the kid. He teased her, he played with her, tennis, cricket, football, tobogganing in a wheelless barrow down a grassy slope in the garden, blackberrying and nutting in the woods on the commons, skating, billiards, archery. Mary wanted to do everything that anybody else in the world could do. Why not billiards? She was sure she could play if they would let her. "Cut the cloth, should I?" cried she. "Oh, how nasty of you!" Mary tried everything, and if she didn't actually adorn everything she touched, she was at least quicker with brain and hand and foot than most girls of her age. She was the kind of child who feels her life in every limb, a frank, fearless creature. "Mary Phelan's high spirits are a little boisterous, but she's thoroughly nice," Mrs. Wentworth said. "And she is a capital companion for Bee, who is much too fond of sitting over a book. And it is a real kindness to have her here. It must be so woefully dull for her at home, and her aunt is very pleasant about it, and likes the child to be here." Happily for the little Mary of those days, her aunt, Miss Farmerlow, was a strong-minded person with ample resources, who was bored by juvenile society and was grateful to the chief lady of the neighbourhood for taking her niece off her hands during the greater part of the day. Punctually, every evening at 7 o'clock in summer, or at 5 in winter, Miss Farmerlow's highly respectable parlourmaid, or in bad weather the gardener, called at Langton House for Miss Mary, and punctually at 10 o'clock every morning, except Sundays, Mary appeared, fresh and beaming, at the schoolroom door, ready to share Beatrice's lessons. Beatrice had taken ever so much more interest in her work since she had had a companion, the governess told Mrs. Wentworth, and indeed Mary's gay temper gave a zest to the schoolroom drudgery, and all those kings and queens in the primers and histories who had been such pale abstractions came to life and were worth reading about. Mary had been allowed to grow wild till she was 10 years old, in accordance with a theory of Miss Farmerlow's, and she was much behind Beatrice when she began to share her studies. But she soon reached her companion's level, and it required considerable management upon the governess's part to keep the humble friend from outstripping the young lady of the house. As a child, a graceful, lively, winning child, and only as a child, Arnold had remembered his little friend. Looking back at the past, and seeing that graceful, childish figure in the picture of his vanished home, it had never occurred to him that the child was growing into a woman, or indeed, it had never occurred to him that there was in that human will-o'-the-wisp the germ of the future woman, or that the passing years must change the character of their friendship should they ever meet again. They had met, and after that first shock of finding her tall and strong and womanly in form and aspect, he had treated her as if she were little Mary still, and the old frankness and freedom teasing her and laughing at her, as in the old times, and spending most of those idle hours in her society. What was there to do at sea but to talk to a girl one liked? There were the children, too, who were perfect limpets in their attachment to him and to Mary, and who would not let them be apart. They were both indispensable in every kind of recreation. The other passengers noted the merry group clustered on the hurricane deck, with wind-blown hair and frocks, Mary as childish in her mirth as the children, and most people took it for granted that Mary and Arnold were engaged lovers, going home to be married.
"I suppose you'll be dreadfully busy about your trousseau directly you land," observed one inquisitive spinster,
who had been troubled in mind about Mary's chaperoneless condition from the beginning of the voyage, and Mary blushed furiously as she explained that she had no trousseau to buy, only a mourning frock or two.
"I ought to be in mourning for my aunt," she said. "And Mr. Wildover is not your fiancé? How odd! We all took you for engaged people."
"How silly of you! Mr. Wildover is an old, old friend, who used to be a kind of playfellow when I was little. He would no more think of being in love with me than he would with you," concluded Mary, casting about for an example of the improbable. She was angry at the spinster's impertinence, and even more angry with herself for blushing so hotly. "I hate the ladies' saloon," she told Arnold afterwards. "It reeks with old maids." When they were within a few days of arrival at Southampton, Mary was hurt at perceiving a change in Arnold's conduct. He left off playing with her and the children, or only joined in their games occasionally when they were too persistent to be denied. "Perhaps he is beginning to be ashamed of me because I have no chaperon," Mary said to herself, after crying a little as she sat alone in her cabin, trying to read an instructive book out of the ship's library, the biography of someone she had never heard of, written by someone equally unknown. "No chaperon! How shall I always hate that word? As if any girl with a grain of sense wanted an old woman to take care of her. One can understand an old woman wanting a girl to help her over the crossings and to put her cap straight, but a girl wanting an old woman is too absurd." Mary Freeland's African and theatrical experiences had inclined her to protest against the restraints and restrictions of conventionality. At Southampton, Arnold bade her goodbye, and having seen her seated in the boat express that was to take her to Waterloo, whence she was going straight to Liverpool Street and Suffolk, there would have been no word said of any future meeting if Mary had not spoken it. "You will be coming to Mervyn Hall to see Mrs. Wentworth," she said, "so I dare say we shall meet before long." "Yes, I dare say," he answered, not very cordially. And then, with a sudden change of manner, which was like a flash of sunshine, "Yes, yes, I must see you again, just once more before I go back to the Cape."
"You mean to go back, then?"
"Oh, dear, yes. What is there for me to do in England? I only came home to see my mother, and to look about me a little bit."
"Oh," said Mary, "I thought you were going to settle down as a respectable member of society."
"No, Mary," he sighed, "I fear that isn't in me, unless, well, it's no good thinking about possibilities. I may not go back for half a year or so, perhaps. Goodbye." The train moved as he pressed the slender hand which lay so willingly in his. He had only time to lift his hat and answer Mary's smile with a smile so much less happy than hers before she was carried out of his sight. "The kid has grown into the sweetest woman I ever met," he muttered to himself as he walked away and tried to lose himself for an hour or so in Southampton. He had refrained from travelling in the train that was taking Mary and most of her fellow passengers because he had made up his mind that her company was not good for him. There was a train at 3 that would get him to London at 5. He had a letter in his pocket that lay upon his heart like lead. Poor Lisa, poor soul, sad companion of saddest days. He looked back and wondered if he was the man who endured that old life and tramped the shabby quarters of the town in shabby boots, with tired brain and languid limbs. He, whose step was now so elastic, whose frame seemed strung with steel.
"If she will be kind and release me," he mused.
He had drifted from the station into the slums of the town, the busy back streets crowded with a curiously mixed population, foreign and oriental faces among seafaring natives, a crowd that suggested Ratcliffe Highway. It was Christmas Eve. The shop windows were heaped with food of all kinds, and gaudy with Christmas emblems, and pork butchers and grocers were vying with each other in the brilliancy of their display. There was a prize pig garlanded with holly and coloured paper, here gin bottles blazing with gilt labels, mountains of plums and currants crowned with rocky ridges of candied peel.
Christmas, the rallying time of love and friendship, mused Arnold. And except Lisa, and perhaps little Mary, and I suppose my mother, I doubt if there's a creature in this country who cares whether I'm alive or dead.
End of chapter 3. Chapter 4 of Rough Justice. This is a Librivox recording. All Librivox recordings are in the public domain. For more information or to volunteer, please visit Librivox.org. Recording by Lena Emsley. Rough Justice by Mary Elizabeth Braddon. Chapter 4. Someone Who Loved Him. For people who like their scenery flat, the neighbourhood of Mervyn Hall might rank as beautiful. Even for the stranger and scoffer at Suffolk landscapes, the river, flowing deep and narrow and straight as a canal through fertile meadows, past old watermills and millers' gabled houses, the pine woods on either side the long level roads, have a certain charm. It is a formal, low-toned beauty, no doubt, the homely charm of broad cornfields and rich pastures. But then the cottages are old and picturesque, the cottage gardens are neatly kept, and the streets of the little town are broad and clean. The marketplace is quaint and odd, and the parish church rises above those modest streets and prim square houses in all the grandeur of a Norman Gothic, almost a cathedral. Arnold Wentworth, alias Wildover, loved the little town, for old sake's sake, albeit he would have eaten his heart out had he been forced to spend his life there, in that respectable isolation from everything else in the world, which the inhabitants considered a dignified seclusion. The sight of meadows and river, bridge and church, touched him with a sense of pain on this Christmas afternoon, as he walked to the inn from the modest terminus of the little branch line from Cambridge. There were no Sunday trains upon this respectable line, but the necessities of the lower classes had urged and secured a train in and a train out on Christmas Day. The train by which Arnold travelled was due at 4, and the dusk of evening was thickening to darkness as he approached the town. It was half a dozen years since he had crossed that bridge and heard that solemn sound of St. Michael's chimes as he heard it now, telling the quarter after 4 from a tower that rose dim in the dusk. There were lighted windows shining in a house whose garden dipped towards the river on his left as he crossed the bridge, a house to which he looked instinctively, for it was Mary's house now, and he wondered if she was keeping Christmas there, and with whom. He would have liked to find out for himself, but he had another mission at Mervyn Hall. There were two highly respectable hotels in the town, both of which seemed somewhat over-capacious for the requirements of a place that had once bristled with mail coaches and post-chaises, but which now depended on a branch line, with 3 trains a day,
and had in some wise lost touch with the outside world, save in the shooting season, when the lords of the soil summoned their kindred and friends for big shoots, and when Mervyn Hall awoke and bestirred itself. Arnold went to neither Antelope nor Crown Hotel, preferring the more secluded accommodation of an old inn outside the town, a straggling old house with an archway entrance and no expectation of a staying guest on Christmas Day. He came here to avoid recognition, which would have been likely at either hotel, in spite of bronzed complexion, bearded chin, and the passage of time. Could he have a bedroom and private sitting room? Yes. He was shown into a large panelled room next the archway, and a maidservant in her Sunday gown knelt down to light the fire. What would he like for dinner, and at what time would he please to dine? Oh, anything you can give me, but not till 8 o'clock. I want a letter taken to Langton Park. Have you any messenger who can be trusted to do exactly what I tell him? A sharp, sensible person? The girl stared at him wonderingly. We got the ostler, she said. The ostler? Christmas Day? I dare say he's been drunk for the last 2 hours. Oh, no, sir. The ostler's my father, and he's very sober man. He don't often take a drop too much. Not often, but Christmas? This would be the very day, perhaps, hesitated Arnold, with a letter in his hand. No, sir, I can answer for father. He's been busy all the morning with a fly, driving people out visiting. He haven't begun to enjoy himself yet. Ask him to come here, then, please. The girl went to fetch her father from the untidy purlieus of the stable, which savoured of pigs and was more agricultural than it had been in the days when the Bear was a coaching house. The man came slouching in, dressed in a kind of compromise between sable fustian and Sunday broadcloth, and to him Arnold entrusted a letter, which he had written in the waiting-room at Cambridge, having found himself with an hour to waste at that unbeautiful station. "You know Langton House?"
"Yes, sir."
"Do you know the servants?"
"The butler, he know me, sir."
As if there were a vast difference. "Well, then, can you ask him to let you see Mrs. Wentworth's maid, Mrs. Green, remember? You are to give this letter to her, to no one else, and you are to wait for an answer." The ostler's eyes twinkled. Waiting for an answer in any decent household meant a mug of beer. It might even run to bread and cheese, or to a glass of spirits at this festive season. Langton House bore a good reputation for kitchen and cellar.
"If I can't see Mrs. Green, sir."
"Bring that letter back."
"Yes, sir."
Langton House was within half a mile of the Bear, a handsome house with an Italian portico and the rest of the front as flat as the soil it stood upon. The house, standing a good way from the road, in 50 acres of meadowland which had been promoted to a park by a little extra planting and the removal of 2 or 3 hedges, and behind which stretched the woods and farmlands that made up Mr. Wentworth's estate. The river ran through the grounds at the back of the house and made a picturesque boundary line between the formal gardens and the park-like pasture. The Wentworths stood well among the smaller gentry of the neighbourhood, very small fry compared with the Earl of Millbank and the Marquis of Cliftonville, who were large landed proprietors, but entitled to respect by long possession of the soil and a name that had never been challenged. The present squire was not an agreeable man. He was haughty and arrogant, a quarrelsome neighbour, a very Draco among magistrates, but he was looked up to for certain qualities that made his neighbours afraid of him, and he was said to give the best dinners that were given outside the gates of Lord Millbank or Lord Cliftonville. He could not boast a chef promoted from a West End club to noble service, but he had the best woman cook that £60 a year could buy, and he was the most exacting master she had ever served. Arnold knew from his youth's experience what this day would be like at Langton House.
There would be no Christmas festivities, no Christmas decorations. The day would be a duller Sunday, duller because an additional Sunday inflicted on the dullness of the week. There would be no relaxation in the duties of cook and kitchen maid, and no hijinks in the servants' hall, and Mr. Wentworth would be a little more difficult about his dinner than usual, because of that extra dullness, the gap in postal deliveries, the hopeless vacuity of London papers, which told only of Christmas entertainments and Christmas excursion trains. Oh, how well Arnold remembered the dreariness of a home Christmas, which had made him long for Cambridge and its free and easy life, even if not a man in the whole university remained up. How he pitied his mother, who had to sit and meekly listen to his father's complainings about agents, servants, finances, everything. And he had pitied his sister for missing the pleasures that Christmas brings to happier schoolrooms. Beatrice Wentworth would have found Christmas duller without the kid. Arnold looked back and recalled the bright image of a 12-year-old tomboy. The streaming hair, the gay young face, the lissom figure, slim ankles, long black legs, racing in the frosty garden, tearing across the wintry park, the riotous games of hide-and-seek in which he had been made to assist, the afternoons by the schoolroom fire, when he had been coaxed to tell ghost stories, all the most frightening stories that he had read in all the Christmas annuals of the year. He mixed plots and characters a little sometimes, and was laughed at for incompetence as a storyteller. "If you have read the story yourself, you oughtn't to make me tell it," he retorted sometimes. "Oh, but we like to hear how you tell it. You're such fun when you mix the white woman in the lady's pictorial with the grey duchess in the queen," protested Mary, or something to that effect. Poor Mary! She had drawn down Mr. Wentworth's wrath upon her girlish head more than once, by some noisy outbreak in the corridors or on the staircase, and had narrowly escaped perpetual banishment from Langton House. And now Arnold thought of his sister as grown up, still unmarried, though 2 or 3 years older than Mary Freeland. Who would come wooing to Langton Park, where the selfish exclusiveness of the master frightened away everybody except his own particular allies and contemporaries, who were allowed to shoot his pheasants and eat his dinners and praise his wine? Poor Beatrice! He thought of her with infinite pity. Yet she doubtless had been taught to pity him, and to think of his lot far worse than hers, feeding upon husks among the swine. He thought of his mother with still deeper pity. Poor soul, she was so miserable, yet scarcely knew her misery. She was one of those weakly amiable wives who hug their chains, who, from a long submission to marital tyranny, and from the knowledge of their own inability to grapple with domestic difficulties, grow to believe in a husband as a heaven-born administrator, to accept his opinions and judgments as infallible, to revere the law that crushes them.
"Will she come to me, dare all, and come to see the reprobate?" he wondered.
He had chosen his hour with judgment. His father was as methodical as a machine, and arranged his days with automatic precision. The interval between tea and dinner was the time in which he wrote his letters. The post-bag was taken to him at 7 o'clock, to be filled and locked by his own hands. At 7:30 he went upstairs to dress. His movements might vary once in a way by 2 or 3 minutes, but even that irregularity was rare. Clocks were scarcely needed at Langton House. Mr. Wentworth's habits, regulated by Mr. Wentworth's watch, would have sufficed to mark the passage of time. From 5:30 to 7:30, Mrs. Wentworth was her own mistress, unless she wanted cheques for tradesmen, in which case she was called upon before the household judge and subjected to an exhaustive interrogation as to the particulars of each account, every item of which Mr. Wentworth ticked with his own hand, guiding his own massive gold pencil case. There never was anything in those accounts for which a house mother need blush. Yet Mrs. Wentworth always felt like a malefactor during that cheque-writing ordeal. Tonight there would be no cheque-writing, and those hours of darkness before dinner would be her own. Arnold had urged her to come to him at the Bear, if possible. The ostler would walk with her, and she would find her son on the road waiting for her. He went out soon after his messenger, and strolled along the broad, level road, of which he knew every feature. The old farmhouse, the great thatched barns on his right, the cottages, the tiny village post office on his left, the vicarage, the mill, the crossroads with a modest house or two hidden in shrubberies of laurel and arbutus, the bridge. Beyond the bridge, the pine woods spread wide over one half the landscape, and gave it all that it had of the picturesque, testifying to a happy inspiration which had prompted a certain Sir Felix Vanbury to plant these sandy flats in the beginning of the century. Halfway between the inn and his father's gates, Arnold saw two figures approaching through the darkness, and quickened his pace almost to a run, very sure that the female figure was his mother. Yes, it was she. He clasped her in his arms, breathless, agitated, clinging to him and kissing him tenderly.
"Oh, my dear Arnold, what happiness!
My dear, dear boy! So long away, so lost to us, except for a poor little letter now and then. Oh, my dear, dear son!" "Dear mother, how sweet that you should be glad to see me, reprobate as I am." "No, no, dear, don't call yourself that. I'm sure you would never do anything really wicked, although you were so unhappy as not to get on with your father."
"I should have been a good deal unhappier if I had got on with him. Oh, my dear mother, forgive me. I know you don't like to hear a word said against your husband."
"No, Arnold, for he is a good husband, a good father, a good master. But you see, dear, it was not your fault. People say nowadays that heredity counts for everything, and you always took after my people. You have the Torrington temper, flaming up at nothing and over in a minute, and it wasn't to be expected that you could get on well with a man of your father's calm and thoughtful character. It doesn't matter, mother dear, as long as you can get on with him quite comfortably. Oh, my dear Arnold, my life would be a very happy life if it were not for losing you. For you see, with Philip so well married and living in Yorkshire on his wife's property, and with you quite away, I seem to have no son. But you have Beatrice, mother. I hope she is good to you." "She is the best of daughters. We visit a great deal." "Why, that's a change from old habits." "Among the poor people, dear. Your father doesn't like company at home, and he doesn't like Beatrice to go out much. Gadding, he calls it, for you know how he's always looked down upon our neighbours here. But we go to Lady Cliftonville's garden party, and to Lady Milbank's 2 Mondays in August, and those are delightful afternoons." "3 afternoons in a year. Poor mother, poor Beatrice." "It is rather dull for Beatrice. And some of the people your father thinks not good enough would be so nice for poor B, if he would only let us know them." "Poor B, indeed. She must be as drowsy as a humble bee by this time. She had such a surprise at church this morning that almost upset her. I was afraid she would have cried out in the middle of the psalms when she saw her."
"When she saw her?"
"Mary Freeland. Mary Freeland! Grown so tall and so nice-looking, dressed in black, in the Roffey's pew."
"Mary Freeland? Ah, she didn't lose any time, then. She only arrived in England yesterday morning."
"How did you know that?"
"Because I came from Africa in the same steamer with her."
"Mary Freeland in Africa? Arnold, what can you mean?"
"Don't be frightened, mother dear. We weren't in Africa together. We met most unexpectedly on the steamer."
"But Mary Freeland,
What could she be doing in Africa?
That's her story. She'll tell you her adventures, no doubt, by the schoolroom fire at tea and toast time.
If your father will let us know her, Mrs. Wentworth murmured despondently. But perhaps he won't, now she's grown up.
Oh, stuff! He wouldn't be such a beast as to boycott little Mary.
Arnold, murmured his mother reproachfully, and then in an awe-stricken whisper, they say she's been on the stage.
And so she has, earning her own living like a plucky girl who wouldn't be badgered into marrying an old fool in a wig for the sake of a home. I admire her pluck, and so ought everybody else. And she was in the charge of an uncle and aunt all through her stage career. There's no room for scandal.
Still, people are shocked, dear. And everyone was tremendously surprised at old Miss Farmiloe having left her so well provided for after all. But tell me about yourself, Arnold, and your own life in Africa. That is what I want to hear, and time is so short.
Oh, but we have plenty of time. You don't dine till 8. You are coming to the Bear with me, and we're going to sit by the fire for an hour or so and talk to our heart's content. And then I'm going to take you quietly home in time to dress for dinner. They were within 5 minutes' walk of the inn when Mrs. Wentworth came to a dead stop.
I couldn't possibly go to the Bear, Arnold. It would be all over Mervyn Hall tomorrow, and it would come to your father's ears, and he would be horrified to think I could go into a public house to meet my son surreptitiously.
If he had not made his son's home intolerable, there would have been no need of surreptitious meetings. But are you really afraid to come and sit by the fire at the old inn? The Bear seemed as quiet as the grave just now, except for a sound of voices from the tap-room across the yard.
Oh, I know the kind of people who go to the tap-room. Our gardeners and grooms and the sexton and the men from the mill. Lots of people who know me. I daren't be seen there, Arnold.
Well, then we can only talk here, walking up and down the road. But you will catch cold.
No, no, I'm quite warm in this sealskin coat.
Happy thought! I saw lights at the Briery. Mary must be keeping Christmas there. Shall we go and look her up?
My dear Arnold, that would be worse. She will have the roughies with her.
It must be the road, then, and you mustn't walk here a minute longer than you like.
I should like to walk with you for hours, dearest. I should not know if I were tired till afterwards.
They turned back and walked the other way, and Arnold told his mother much about his lucky years at Witwatersrand, but not a word of those years of trouble in London. He had written to her, even when things were at their worst, for he would not have had her tortured by the thought that he might be dead. 4 times a year, whenever he might, he wrote briefly, under cover, to his mother's faithful maid, Anne Green, to report himself alive and well. And now her heart throbbed with gladness as he told her of his good fortune, and that his future life might be smooth and prosperous if he were prudent enough to stick to the money he had made and live upon the interest of his capital. "I shall have 400 or 500 a year," he said, "and if I were to marry a nice girl with 300 or 400 of her own, we could live somewhere in the country, and we might keep 2 or 3 hunters and some shooting dogs. For we shouldn't want luxuries or finery, both being used to rough it."
"Both? Do you mean that you are engaged, Arnold?" his mother interrupted excitedly.
His sunburnt face reddened in the darkness.
"No, no, mother, not engaged," with a deep sigh. "I was talking nonsense, that's all." "Oh, Arnold, I should love you to marry and settle near us. If you were doing well and had married a nice girl, I'm sure your father would forgive you."
"Would he, do you think? Forgive me for outrunning my allowance at the Varsity by a few hundreds, and never costing him a shilling afterwards?" Arnold said scornfully.
"It wasn't the money he felt, dear. It was the disappointment. Oh, Arnold, my dear son, you have made me so proud and so happy tonight. So proud to think you were able to make your fortune without a friend to help you.
You're wrong there. I had a friend, a college friend, one of those friends I won for myself while I was spending those extra hundreds. From a purely commercial point of view, that one friend was worth all the money, for it was his capital that started me in Africa. How sweet of him! What a dear fellow he must be! How I should love to know him!
I doubt that, mother. He's as good as gold, but he swears like a trooper, and never goes to church.
How sad! And I was thinking that he would make such a nice husband for B.
Ah, mother, simple and sanguine as of old, years have not changed you. I wish I could see your dear face. I think I must light a match and look at you.
Don't, dearest. You would see how old and careworn I have grown.
Careworn? Ah, poor mother, and you pretend your life is happy.
There are always cares for a mistress of a house, Arnold, in the happiest life. English cooks are so stupid, and I have never denied that your father is a little exacting. But how can I remember trifling worries now you have come home and done so well for yourself? You will never go back to Africa, will you, dear? Promise me that.
No, no, mother dear, I can't. That would be to promise away my life, to make lifelong fetters with words. I hope to stop in England. If I can be happy here, I will stop. And if I can live near you, I will. But if I find I can't be happy in England, I shall go back to the mines and make some more money.
His mother pleaded with him,
and he answered her with all affection and gentleness, and told her that he meant to make himself a home within easy reach of her, if his hopes could be realised. He would not tell her what those hopes were, though she urged him to confide in her. And at the lodge gate they parted, with words of affection on both sides, and Mrs. Wentworth walked slowly along the avenue to the big white house, shedding a few tears as she went.
"It is so sad that he cannot get on with his father," she sighed, "and that we must sit down to our Christmas dinner without him."
Arnold was in no hurry to go back to the Bear and to a solitary meal in the panelled parlour, which smelt of worm-eaten wood and rotten rose-leaves.
He walked past his inn and on to Mervyn Hall, and loitered on the bridge for the space of a pipe of tobacco, looking at the lighted windows of the Briery. How cheerily the warm lamplight shone across the garden by the river. She was there, his little Mary, in the prim drawing-room he remembered in old Miss Farmelow's lifetime, a room whose threshold he had crossed with awe, never knowing what he ought to say to that severe spinster. He pictured Mary, playing hostess to some of the Roffey family, elated with the sense of possession and independence, a young woman with a comfortable income, youth, health, good looks, high spirits, and able to dispose of her life as she pleased. He would have liked to walk in among them and surprise her, but he was doubtful how he would be received by the Roffey brood. He had left Mervyn Hall under a cloud, as a son who had been idle and extravagant at the university, and whom his father had cast off. He would be looked upon as a profligate adventurer, no doubt, by those serious church-going Roffeys, more especially as Roffey was his father's solicitor, and affected a profound veneration for the sage of Langton Park. No, it would not do to call upon Miss Freeland at 8 o'clock in the evening. He went back to the Bear, dined on tough beef, and felt inexpressibly dreary as he sat by a sullen fire, thinking not of Mary Freeland, but of another woman whose face haunted him and would not be banished, although he tried his hardest to shut it out of his thoughts. "What is the use of regretting things that are inevitable?" he muttered to himself, as he bent over the smoky fire and knocked about the coals savagely. He lighted pipe after pipe, smoked till the room was cloudy with tobacco, sat long after everybody else at the Bear had gone to bed, tired but dreading sleeplessness in the bedroom above, and knowing that he should not be able to sleep. He came downstairs late next morning, looking haggard and unhappy, and at 12 o'clock he went to the Briery and asked to see Miss Freeland. Mary came singing out of the parlour while he was talking to the maid. She flushed and brightened at seeing him, and came to him with outstretched hand.
"I thought you wouldn't leave Mervynhall without calling upon me," she said. "I was just going into the garden to look round my domain. Will you come with me?"
"Of course I will come. When last I was in your orchard, you were being scolded for having picked an apple, and now the trees and the orchard are yours." Poor old auntie! Wasn't it sweet of her to relent, and not leave her fortune to the other idiots? Everybody is so kind. People made quite a fuss about me after church yesterday. So surprised, so glad to see me. Mr. and Mrs. Roffey are staying with me to make things comfortable and correct for me while I am at the Briery, and they have lent me a parlourmaid to help our old cook, who has been in charge of everything since my aunt's death. It seems wonderful to be well off, and for people to be so prim and particular about me, after running wild all the time I was with those dear Favershams. And now you are enjoying the privileges of respectability."
"Yes, I find it rather nice to be respectable, and to be warned that I must never ride in a hansom or an omnibus alone. Do you know, I am quite a landed person. I have nearly 20 acres.
Here she began to count upon her fingers. "The flower garden and orchard, 3½. The kitchen garden on the other side of the road, 1¼. The 3 paddocks, 15. But how egotistical I am, preaching about acres.
Tell me how you found your dear mother, and wasn't she awfully glad to see you?"
"Yes, she was very glad, though she could only meet me by stealth, poor soul, and would no more dare tell my father of my presence at Mervynhall than she would tell him she had invited a burglar or a forger to dinner. Somebody says all things work around in time and wind up well, and I dare say sooner or later my father will begin to think that a young man who has exceeded his allowance by 300 or 400 pounds and failed to get a degree may not be quite a malefactor. And then I shall be readmitted to the pleasures of home life and hear my father swear at the cook."
"Arnold, you must not be flippant. It's a very serious thing to quarrel with a father. I, who have no father, feel how shocking it is."
"Yes, I have observed that orphans have an exalted estimate of the paternal relation. But Mary, Mary, never contrary to me, tell me your plans. What use are you going to make of your wealth?"
"Every use. First and foremost, I shall improve myself."
"Don't. There's a kind of dog-rose perfection which cultivation only spoils."
"Nonsense. I'm going to board with the Tressilian Smiths in South Kensington.
Depressing neighbourhood. Mrs. Tressilian Smith is a sister of Mrs. Roffey's. Their grandmother was a Tressilian, and Mrs. Roffey's sister has taken the name and hyphen. Her husband is a medical man who is steadily getting to the top of the tree, and she gives a delightful evening party every week in the London season."
"As you hear from Mrs. Roffey."
"Then I am going to attend classes at the School of Music."
"Oh, Mary, that is contrary. Contrary to common sense. Are there not enough piano torturers in the world that you should join the ranks? You, who rebelled against five-finger exercises as sheer cruelty?"
"That was because I was working on the wrong method, and holding my wrist anyhow. I shall enjoy the work when I am taught in the right way."
"Foolish, deluded Mary."
"And then I shall go to the art school, and work at the antique."
"Mary, have you 1/2 of talent for quoit players and armless Venuses?"
"I don't know till I try. And I shall have lessons in Parisian French, and I shall learn a little Italian. And then I shall travel."
"What? Have you not travelled enough while you were a strolling player? You have scoured England and Ireland, and you have been to Africa. Is not that enough?"
"It is nothing. I want to see France, Italy, Germany, Spain, perhaps.
I shall live abroad for ever so long." She looked at him searchingly as she made this last announcement. He looked smilingly back at her, but even while the smile brightened his face, she could see that he was looking haggard and ill. "What have you been doing since you left the steamer? You're looking so tired and worn out."
"Am I? It is not that I've done much to tire myself, but perhaps my dismal Christmas has made me look seedy."
"You look really ill. Did you come straight to Mervynhall on Christmas Eve? I didn't see you on our train. Mr. Roffey met me at Waterloo. Wasn't it good of him?"
"Very, but you are his client. No doubt the goodness will go down in his bill."
"Oh, I think not. He said he had made business in town on purpose to meet me and take care of me. He couldn't bear to think of me driving across to Liverpool Street alone. Funny, wasn't it, considering that I'd come from the Cape alone? Were you in our train, the 4:50 from Liverpool Street?"
"No, I stayed in London till yesterday morning."
"And came here by the one slow Christmas Day train? How foolish of you!"
"I had business in London."
"Oh, and how long are you going to stop at the Bear?"
"Only till this afternoon."
"You are in a great hurry to go away again."
"I might make things unpleasant for my mother if I were seen about here. And Mary, I may call upon you at South Kensington, may I not? And perhaps, as a very old friend, I might be permitted to take you for an hour's stroll in the Broadwalk, or to look at the riders in the Row."
"I don't think that would be allowed. Mrs. Roffey says that Mrs. Tressilian Smith is very particular. I am to drive in the park with her 3 or 4 times a week in Dr. Smith's Victoria. I am evidently destined to drive in a doctor's carriage."
"Well, at least you will let me call."
"It will all depend on Mrs. Tressilian Smith." "I mean to be intensely respectable," said Mary, with tremendous emphasis. "After living the dear happy-go-lucky life with Uncle and Aunt Faversham, and being allowed to do and say just what I liked, prunes and prisms will be an amusing change. I shall have Mrs. Smith's own maid, who is an upper housemaid as well, to walk across to the museum with me, though it's only 5 minutes' walk. Mrs. Roffey says nothing would induce her sister to let me go out alone. Then I shall waylay you and bribe the housemaid to say she has seen you safe into the museum, while you have marched off to Kensington Gardens with me." Mary shook her glove at him. The morning air was so mild that she had been carrying her glove instead of wearing it on the hardy little weather-beaten hand. She was in the gayest spirits, and Arnold inhaled joy from the atmosphere that surrounded her. For him, her aura was of a brilliant rose colour, and meant happiness. They walked around the garden 2 or 3 times, talking gaily, talking as conscious lovers talk when love is freshest and sweetest because still undeclared. Their talk was lighter than vanity, futile, evanescent, but it was happiness enough for each to be with the other. "Look," cried Mary, "there's the postman. Let's go in and see what he's brought me."
"I hope he's brought you a London paper," said Arnold, "for I haven't seen one since the day before yesterday."
"Poor thing," laughed Mary. "Isn't it dreadful suffering? That accounts for you looking so ill."
They went into the hall and found the servant in the act of sorting and studiously examining the letters.
"Here's the Times addressed to Roffey. Do you think I may open it?" asked Arnold.
"I think I may," said Mary, tearing off the wrapper. "There, go and read the news, man, while I look at my Christmas cards from the people who were surprised to see me yesterday. And here's an African letter from the dear aunt, and one from Helena Champernowne, such a jolly girl, who gets shoved on for all the wretched old women, and has to make up ugly half her time."
"Shocking murder in Bloomsbury," read Arnold. "What a godsend for Boxing Day newspapers."
Mary was standing with her back to him at the hall table, opening her letters and spreading out her Christmas cards approvingly. "All sixpenny ones at the very least," she said. "What it is to have come into property. A murder, did you say? How nice. I hope it's a lovely poisoning case, among genteel people. I hate vulgar murders." There was no answer. "Is it poison?" she asked casually, while she was reading her aunt's letter. Again, no answer. She looked round, puzzled at his silence, in spite of her divided attention. He was leaning against the wall, white as death, and speechless. "Arnold, what's the matter? Do you know the people?" "No. No, no, only it's too horrid. It turned me sick." End of chapter 4. Chapter 5 of Rough Justice. This is a Librivox recording. All Librivox recordings are in the public domain. For more information or to volunteer, please visit Librivox.org. Recording by Lena Emsley. Rough Justice by Mary Elizabeth Braddon. Chapter 5. At number 13, Dynevor Street. It was 9 o'clock on the morning of Christmas Day when Mr. John Faunce, Chief Inspector of the Bow Street Division, looked in at the station to see whether the night that was over had been marked by any incident of sufficient importance to spoil his holiday and to deprive his good wife of the chief ornament to a family dinner which was to take place at 6 o'clock that evening in the cosiest of dining rooms on a certain second floor in Bloomsbury. The chief inspector lived in his division, knew every house door in his division, and the chief inspector's wife, however she may have sighed for the pleasantness of a suburban villa in the smiling valley of the Thames, or on airy heights at Hampstead or Highgate, had to content herself with the upper part of a substantial old house in the neighbourhood of Russell Square.
"Nothing that need spoil my Christmas Day," said Mr. Faunce, when he had heard all that the inspector in charge of the station had to tell him. "For once in a way I shall be able to eat my Christmas dinner with the little woman." He was leaving the office, contemplating the possibility of attending morning service with his wife, and dropping into a comfortable nap under her favourite evangelical preacher, whose sermons were of the longest, when he remembered a case of a missing child in the subdivision, in which he was personally interested on account of his knowledge of the parents, worthy, hard-working people, who kept a small shop for fruit and vegetables, and with whom Mrs. Faunce had dealt for some years. These poor creatures had been thrown into an agony of apprehension by the disappearance of a son of 5 years old, who had strayed off unobserved on the previous afternoon, and had not been heard of up to midnight. "I'll see if they've found the Adleys' boy before I go home," Mr. Faunce said to himself as he walked briskly towards the subdivisional office in Gunter Street. He found a sergeant in charge in the absence of the inspector. "Boy found?" he asked, before inquiring the case of this irregularity. "Yes, sir, found in Covent Garden, asleep under an orange box at 2 o'clock this morning. Father has been in the habit of taking him there now and then for a treat. Boy marched off and found his way there, played about all evening with blackguard boys, and then fell asleep behind one of the orange stalls, and nobody sets eyes on him till one of the constables happened upon him."
"I'm very glad they've got him, and I hope they've given him a sound thrashing."
"I'm afraid they're not up to it, sir. They was a-making a right down fool of him when the constable left him, cramming him with cakes and toffee."
"He'll run away again. They always do, if it isn't flogged out of him. Where's the inspector?"
"He's gone round to Dynevor Street, sir."
"What's up there?"
"Murder, sir. A young woman shot through the head. Number 13, Dynevor Street. Lodging house."
"Is it a respectable house?"
"A doubtful party on the second floor, but no bad goings on inside. I've questioned the neighbours."
murderer unknown?" "Not a trace of him, though the second floor saw him leave the house. It was a most audacious business. The young woman lets herself in with a latchkey at 1 o'clock this morning. The second floor hears her go upstairs. Hears a man's footsteps following 2 minutes afterwards. Then hears the report of a pistol. And the second floor rushes onto the landing and sees a man going downstairs."
"Death instantaneous, of course?"
"Lord save you, yes, sir," answered the sergeant, with a look of recalling a dreadful vision.
"Did no one but the second floor lodger hear or see anything?"
"See? No one. The landlady heard the shot. She was sleeping on the top floor, you see. Room opposite the murdered woman. She sends her slavey shrieking out into the street in a nightgown and petticoat, and the girl almost tumbles into my arms, screaming murder."
"The murdered woman was a loose character, I suppose?"
"They say not, sir. Honest and respectable. Scraping a living somehow. Near starving pretty often."
"Do they think she brought the man home with her?"
"Nobody knows, but it seems likely she brought him to the door anyhow, and she must have left the door open, unless he had a key that would open it."
"Is that all you've been able to find out?" asked Faunce.
"That's about all, sir. There's nothing but the women in the house. The first floor husband's a commercial, and he's away. The rest are single women. They're all about mad, poor creatures, and they all want to talk at once, and tell things that haven't any bearing on the case. But I expect you'll calm them down a bit."
Mr. Faunce nodded, put on his hat, and left the office. The morning was dim and dusky, the sun slowly climbing up in a cloudy sky behind the housetops eastward. Dynevor Street looked its worst, perhaps, at this bleak hour, while the winter day was still unwarmed by household fires, and the monotony of the long, dull street was still unbroken by traffic. The lamps had only just been extinguished by a yawning lamplighter. Here and there a maidservant with nipped nose hearthstoned a doorstep or beat a dusty mat against the area railings. Mr. Faunce's keen eye noted the aspect of everything he passed, quickly as he was walking. He knew the character of the street and its population, and he knew the individual differences of every house as well as he knew the features of his familiar friends. Shabby genteel, affecting respectability, but worse than doubtful at bottom. That was his opinion of Dynevor Street. There was a little crowd about the door, a cluster of shabby idlers who had been standing there since daybreak on the chance of seeing something ghastly, and there was a policeman on guard in front of the closed street door. He put in a key and opened the door as Faunce approached, and the chief inspector went straight up to the third floor, where he expected to find his subordinate, the inspector in charge of the subdivisional station. A tall, elderly woman in a slovenly gown and a rusty black lace cap, a trap for dust rather than a headdress, came up the kitchen stairs and followed Faunce to the top of the house. This was Mrs. Grogan, the landlady, but number 13 was in the custody of the police today, and poor Mrs. Grogan felt it even less her house than in that dark period when there was a bailiff's man in possession, crouching over a scanty fire in the underground den which she called her sitting-room. She went panting upstairs and arrived at the top landing breathless, for lean as she was, the four flights were too much for her. The subdivisional inspector had the key of the back room and opened the door for Mr. Faunce.
"You'll find everything as it was when the sergeant called in, sir," said the inspector. "I took care that nothing was touched after I came, and this good lady told me nothing had been touched."
Nothing, not even that dreadful figure on the ground, lying as it fell, the poor disfigured head half hidden by the shabby black hat. One meagre arm and one white hand stretched along the discoloured carpet, the other doubled under the body, the worn-out boots and thin ankles exposed below the edge of a black stuff gown,
Nobody, not even a doctor, had touched that sad figure. A doctor's eyes had looked at it, and a doctor's lips had pronounced the fact which was obvious to every eye, instantaneous death. The story told by the corpse was brief and conclusive. The story told by the room was of the baldest. Faunce's keen eyes scrutinised every object in that room, and his deft fingers touched and turned over everything movable. The story was of abject poverty, but not of abject vice. The inspector found no tawdry frippery, no powder puff and pennyworth of French chalk, no paper or vermilion, no tales of false hair, and above all, no dirt. The wretched furniture was as clean as a woman's care could make it. A skinny iron bedstead, a painted chest of drawers with a blurred looking-glass upon it, a basin and jug on a shelf in the corner. On the chest of drawers a crockery candlestick and candle, blown out directly it had been lighted, as the state of the wick told Mr. Faunce. A cheap paraffin candle. He looked in all the drawers. Clothes to speak of there were none. A single change of linen, and a black marine petticoat that had been mended over and over again till it hung in shreds, were all Mr. Faunce could find in the way of personal property, with the exception of a little black book that had been much read, the New Testament in the German language. "Honest, virtuous, and pious," thought Faunce, as he turned the leaves of the Testament and found a violet or a primrose here and there between the pages. He laid down the little black book on the chest of drawers where he had found it, and proceeded with his investigation. So far he had not discovered a letter or document of any kind, but in a corner near the door Mr. Faunce's keen glance lighted on a crumpled brown paper bag, which he stooped to pick up and examined as eagerly as if he expected to find the clue to the mystery of the woman's death in a fruiterer's bag. Crimes have been brought home to the guilty upon indications as trivial. The bag had held grapes. There were some stalks and a grape or two at the bottom of it. The fruiterer's name was printed on it, Jakins, Covent Gardens. This bag was, from Faunce's point of view, a valuable item in the sum of evidence. He even noted the manner in which it was crumpled, as if it had been crushed in the fevered grasp of a nervous hand. He put the bag in his letter case and went on with his investigation. "There must be something in her pocket," he said. The two men knelt down, handling the dead form very gently, and Faunce found a pocket in the thin black gown. Nothing in the pocket, except a clean cambric handkerchief with an embroidered L in the corner, very old and thin and worn, but an expensive handkerchief. "Hmm," muttered the inspector. "Not quite so virtuous as I thought, perhaps. A come-downer." He unhooked the front of the bodice, spattered and stained so dreadfully that even the chief inspector's strong nerves, hardened amidst scenes of horror, thrilled as he touched that murdered form. "She may have carried papers in her bosom," he said. "Women often do." He was right. Between gown and undergarment he found a little bundle of paper, which he took out and unfolded. It was a bundle of banknotes, carelessly folded across. They were notes on the Standard Bank of South Africa, endorsed with a name and date, and they amounted in all to £120. Here was an important discovery, which must needs lead to something. Was the woman murdered by someone who knew of this money and meant to get it from her? One other detail he noted as he knelt beside the lifeless form. The woman had worn a large white silk handkerchief, a man's muffler, tied round her neck. It was very old. The silk was worn and thin, and the edges were ragged. But in one corner Mr. Faunce found a monogram, neatly worked in silk, that had once been crimson. A.W. Initials were always interesting to Mr. Faunce. He made a note of these. True, she might have bought the silken rag at a pawn shop, but initials were always worth recording. Somewhere in the world there was the original owner of this handkerchief, and wherever he was, it was possible that in the past or in the present might be found some link between him and the dead woman lying here. The next thing was to learn the history of the crime, as known to the people in the house. The inspector left the room with his subordinate, locking the door behind him, and addressed himself to Mrs. Grogan, who stood whimpering upon the landing.
"Have you made out anything, sir?" she asked.
"Not much. I want to hear all you can tell me about your lodger. I want to see anyone in the house who can tell me anything about the murderer. I'm told that a lodger on the floor below saw him."
"That's Mrs. Delamere, sir. She did get a glimpse of him, there's no doubt, but it was only a glimpse, and she wouldn't recognise him if you was to bring him into the house this minute. She's been awfully upset ever since, poor lady, and they've had to give her champagne and chloral to quiet her nerves."
"Never mind her nerves, madam. I should like to see her. But first, perhaps, you'll be so good as to tell me all you can about the murdered woman and her friends and belongings."
"She had nobody belonging to her that I ever saw, sir," Mrs. Grogan answered. "But perhaps she'd step down to my room and talk things over quietly. I've a bit of a fire there."
"No, no. There is no one about up here, is there?"
"Now, sir, that's my bedroom,"
opening a door and shutting it again quickly, but not before Faunce's quick survey had assured him that the room was empty.
"That's where I sleep, and the girl. Mrs. Rayner was the only other person on this floor, and Mrs. Delamere has the two rooms below."
"And on the first floor?"
"Mr. and Mrs. Joynson. He's a commercial gentleman in the silk trade, and seldom at home for more than a night or two at a time."
"And on the ground floor?"
"Mrs. Binning, a widow lady in the dressmaking. She has both parlours and a workroom at the back. I only hope this dreadful business won't drive them all away. Mrs. Delamere says she can't sleep another night in the house. But then she saw her. The others didn't. The horror of it ain't brought home to them."
And then Mrs. Grogan allowed the story of Lisa Rayner's death to be elicited from her, clouded with much irrelevant matter about her own affairs and duties, being, as it was, Christmas Eve, and she with more to do than usual, being up till 12 o'clock trussing a turkey for Mrs. Joynton, who expected friends to dinner, her husband's father and mother, her own niece and niece's husband, and was to dine at 4 o'clock. A most awkward hour, wanting everything dished by candlelight, and might as well have made it as regular late dinner at once. And she, Mrs. Grogan, had gone up to bed dog-tired, and she was sound asleep, and the girl too, when she was waked by the sound of a pistol fired,
as it might be close to her ear, and the girl just groaned and turned over, and never woke. Them young things would sleep through an earthquake. And she rushed out to the landing and met Mrs. Delamere coming upstairs, and they went into Mrs. Rayner's room and saw her lying there. And it was an awful sight, which never would she till her dying day be able to forget, nor yet Mrs. Delamere. And she was afraid that ghastly spectacle would drive away her lodger, the best lodger in her house, though only a second floor, and her with the most feeling heart for another woman, which there was many lady lodgers would make a slave of their landlady and never say thank you, much less offer you a glass of anything warm and comfortable.
And as for the poor creature that had been murdered, well, all Mrs. Grogan could say of her was harmless.
An harmless, unoffending creature whom one couldn't have the heart to turn into the street, though much behind with her rent, but always willing to work at anything, however humble,
ready to work her fingers to the bone rather than not pay her just debts. "'She's done many a day's charing for me in lieu of rent,' said Mrs. Grogan. "'Though anybody could see she was born above it, she hadn't a bit of pride, though she must once have been very pretty. "'But she had no regular calling. "'Well, sir, she was clever with her needle, and off and on Mrs. Benning would employ her for a week or two, and she always gave satisfaction.' Those were her best times. But you see, sir, when you can get prentices and improvers that'll work for you for nothing, it ain't likely you'll employ anyone as you has to pay oftener than you can help. And it was only in the busiest times Mrs. Rayner got work downstairs. Other times she managed the best she could, getting odd jobs here and there, always patient, but always melancholy. She was a bit eccentric, poor soul, and would wander late at night, wander and wander, through the quiet squares and streets, as far as Primrose Hill, or even up to Hampstead Heath. And she said it was the only thing as done her good. She got out of herself a bit, she says, when she walked fast under the starlit sky, or could roam about alone on the heath and feel the wind blowing in her face. I wish I was in Africa, in some wilderness, she used to say. Africa? Faunce thought of those notes in his charge, notes on the bank at Johannesburg. How long has she been with you?
Nearly 2 years.
And in all that time you saw no one belonging to her?
No one.
And never heard anything about the people she belonged to, or the kind of life she'd led before she came to this house?
Nothing. She was as close. I don't even know where she'd been living last before she came to me. She gave me no reference, but there was a look about her that made me think she was honest and respectable. And in spite of her prowling about at night, I never had reason to think otherwise.
What time did she go out last night?
I believe she went out early in the evening, but I didn't see her go. Other lodgers mostly bang the door after them, shake the house till it makes one nervous to hear 'em. But she'd go and come like a spirit.
Did no one come to see her yesterday?
No one.
Did she get any letter or telegram?
There was a telegram. Came for her after dark. First I ever knew her get. And she was very much upset when she got it. The girl took it upstairs to her, and she said the poor thing was all in a tremble when she opened it.
Mr. Faunce asked to see the girl, who was produced, agitated and grimy, from the kitchen. She could tell him no more than her mistress had done. Mrs. Rayner had snatched the telegram from her hand, and had shook as if she was going to drop. Her hands trembled so that she could hardly tear open the envelope, but she had said nothing.
Did the girl know at what hour she left the house?
No. She waited upon herself, and nobody troubled about her. She had come down to the kitchen for her loaf and halfpenny of milk before the telegraph boy came, and her tea things was on the table when the girl took the telegram to her. So it was after tea when she went out.
That was all the girl knew about her. After this, Mr. Faunce asked to be introduced to Mrs. Delamere, and was at once received by that lady, who was anxious to tell him her story, and was less inclined to ramble than Mrs. Grogan. She knew nothing of the telegram, nor did she know when Mrs. Rayner left the house, but she had heard her moving about in her room overhead while she, Mrs. Delamere, was dressing to go out, between 6 and 7. She happened to be going to a place of entertainment that evening. She told Mr. Faunce how, lying broad awake a few minutes before 1 o'clock, she had heard footsteps pass her door and go upstairs. She knew Lisa Rayner's step, and then, not 2 minutes after, she heard other footsteps following, cautious steps and not heavy, but she thought they were a man's footsteps, and wondered how Mrs. Rayner came to bring a man into the house at that hour, knowing her to be a well-conducted young woman. But she had hardly time to wonder before she heard the report of a pistol. and instantly, almost at the same moment, a heavy fall on the floor above. Her bedroom was exactly under Mrs. Rayner's room. She knew something dreadful must have happened, and she rushed out to the landing in time to see a man going downstairs. About this man's appearance, the inspector questioned her searchingly. He had seated himself beside her comfortable fire, making himself at home with a friendly air, which was more soothing to Mrs. Delamere's nerves than chloral or brandy. His quick eyes looked round her room in a pleasant way, as if he were admiring the photographs of actors and actresses, and the showy French lithographs with which she had relieved the dinginess of the sage-green wallpaper. She answered all his questions unreservedly, but she had only seen the man's head and shoulders for an instant as he ran downstairs. There was no light but the candle she was holding. She heard the street door shut softly while she stood looking, and then came Mrs. Grogan's shriek from above, and other doors opened below, and the house was alive with frightened women wanting to know what had happened. She recalled, shuddering, the spectacle on the floor above, and told him how Mrs. Grogan had pulled her out of the room and had locked the door, taking the key out of the lock.
"They all came tearing up the next minute, Mrs. Benning and her apprentice, a silly, shrieking girl, and Mrs. Joynson from the first floor. But old Grogan was cute enough to keep the door locked. No one must go in but the police, she told them. She knew very well that if her other lodgers saw what I saw, she'd have a week's notice from both floors. Nobody would stay in a house to have the horrors as I've had 'em all night."
"But surely, my dear madam, a woman of your superior mind—" "Ah, that's where it is," Mrs. Delamere interrupted sharply.
"If I had no imagination, I might be able to sleep comfortably in the room under hers, without even seeing her as I saw her last night, and without ever watching the ceiling, expecting to see the horrible stains oozing through the whitewash. No, Mr. Faunce, I don't stay an hour in these rooms after I've suited myself elsewhere. But, of course, that's not an easy thing to do on Christmas Day, no, nor on Boxing Day neither, so I may have to stay till the day after tomorrow. Anyhow, I shall pay old Grogan a week's rent. She'll have to fresh paper her rooms and smarten up the house a bit after the funeral. Goodness knows the place has wanted it long enough."
The next point was to lead Mrs. Delamere gently on to a discourse freely about the dead woman, of whom she affected to have known more than anyone else in the house. "The poor thing was a born lady, however low she might have fallen, and I don't believe she was ever really low, though no doubt she had had her trials, as we all have when Providence has made us attractive."
"And she had been attractive, you think?"
"That poor disfigured creature upstairs," with a shuddering sob, "was once a pretty woman. She was the wreck of a pretty woman yesterday when she passed me on the stairs. Oh, if I could forget what she is now!"
Mrs. Delamere clutched a small stoppered bottle from the mantelpiece, dipped a needle into it, and stabbed herself in the wrist half a dozen times in a spasmodic way.
"Don't you think that's a rather bad habit of yours, ma'am?"
asked the inspector, who felt himself on such confidential terms as permitted a friendly remonstrance.
"Oh, I can't help it. I couldn't live if I didn't do it. It's that or chucking oneself out of a window. I suppose chloral's the best of the two."
"An attractive lady like yourself, ma'am, oughtn't to hold life so cheap."
Mrs. Delamere sighed and shook her head.
"It isn't the pretty women that have the best luck, or that poor thing upstairs would have done better."
"Did she never open her heart to you, and talk freely of her past life?"
"Never, though I've brought her in here sometimes when I've heard her dragging upstairs dead beat, and once in a way she'd accept a trifle of a dress from me, a bonnet or such like. She could do up a bonnet that I should have thrown on the dust heap, and look the lady in it. She had such clever fingers, and such natty ways."
"Had she begun life as a milliner's or dressmaker's apprentice, do you think?"
Lord knows, but I believe she had too much education for that. I showed her a letter from a lady friend in Paris, and she read it right off, and wrote the answer for me. French came as easy to her as English, but where she learnt the language and how she began I could never find out. I knew nothing, except that she was very fond of someone who was far away.
Did she say where he was?
Not she. Indeed, I don't believe she knew. I shall never see him again, she said once. If he was alive, he has forgotten me. If he is dead, I shall never know where he lies. And yet our two lives were once so knitted together that I didn't think fate could part them. Oh, my dear, says I, fate can play us an ugly trick. I have no patience with fate.
Faunce took leave of the lady after this. A respectable, white-headed gentleman, in glossy broadcloth, came upstairs as he opened the door, and said with some asperity,
"You really oughtn't to have sent for me today, Julia. You ought to know that I have to go to church with the family at 11.
"I didn't ought to have sent, indeed. Perhaps you would like to find me a raving lunatic when you come here next week."
Thus the lady, with hysterical shrillness. Faunce passed the white-haired gentleman on the landing, and went downstairs, where Mrs. Grogan hovered in the passage waiting for him.
"Have you got a clue to the wretch who killed her?" she asked eagerly.
"No, ma'am. Clues don't grow on trees."
End of chapter 5.